Reverend Tamika Moore just voted among the top leaders in this particular city. Our dear brother Reverend William P. Moore and the First Lady Pauline. We want to thank the praise team and all of their great music. And finally, we want to thank our beloved community partner, the Prometheus Radio Project.
All right, there's the show, then here's the last piece, Jay. Here we go, in 3, 2. Special thanks to our local media partner, WURDAM. They will air all 3 hours of this program in the very near future. Special thanks to Reverend William B. Moore, First Lady Pauline Moore, Reverend Tamika Moore, the entire 10th Memorial Baptist Church family, and of course the praise team and the wonderful music. And finally, to our community partner, we thank the Prometheus Radio Project. All right, got all that out the way. All right, now, enough of the technical stuff. Let's get this conversation started. Tell me you ready, Jay? Hit that clock and we can go. You ready? All right. Everybody good? Here we go. In 3, 2, 1. From Philadelphia, I'm Tavis Smiley.
And I'm Cornel West.
Welcome to the third stop on our Poverty Tour 2.0. In case you missed the first couple of stops, we are today in the city of brotherly love and, as I like to say, sisterly affection. I love the city of Philadelphia. Let's hear it for Philadelphia. That's what I thought. Yeah. I have two favorite American cities, Philadelphia and Chicago. I live in LA, but all around the country, around the world. But I love Philly and I love Chicago. I love the love that I feel when I walk around this city. I've been coming here for years and I've never done a tour. I've written 16 books, 17 books for years.
I've never done a tour.
I've never done a tour.
For books or my technology summits, my health summits, the symposia, State of the Black Union, when I was with Tom Joyner of the Sky Shows. I've never done anything where Philadelphia wasn't on the list.
Coming through Philadelphia.
I always come through Philadelphia because I just love it.
It's been consecrated by John Coltrane and Jill Scott and the Roots and Gamble and Huff. From the Scott and the Roots. The Teddy Bear. Theodore Pendergrass himself, and Phyllis Hyman. No, she's from Pittsburgh, but she spent time here, didn't she?
Yeah. It's a great city, and I'm always pleased to come back. I wish we were here today under different circumstances, but we're here today as part of our, as I mentioned, our Poverty Tour 2.0. Last year, Dr. West and I went on the Poverty Tour 1.0, I guess, in retrospect. We went to 9 states and 18 cities, trying to get a better understanding of what poverty really looks like in this country. You know, there are a lot of misnomers about poverty, about what it is, about what it isn't, about who's in poverty. So often we talk about poverty, we think of it as something color-coded. That is to say, you say poverty, you think black, you may think brown. But there's so many misnomers, so many myths. Dr. West and I have a book out called The Rich and the Rest of Us, A Poverty Manifesto. And in that book, we try to debunk some of the worst lies that are told about poverty and told about poor people. So we wanted to go out amongst the country, 9 states, 18 cities, talking to people of all races, all colors, and all creeds, trying to get a better understanding of what the poverty situation is, the poverty problem in America really is. That was last year. So here we are now back again this year with the Poverty Tour 2.0, the second time around. And we are now, of course, in that window. As I like to say, the sprint between Labor Day to Election Day is when the attention of the nation is focused so intently on the presidential race. We know the two front runners, President Obama and Governor Romney. And the truth of the matter is that neither one of them have said enough as yet about the issue of poverty. Now, there are 4 debates in front of us, and we've been saying all along that these debate moderators need to put the issue of poverty front and center in these debates. Let me take you back right quick. 4 years ago, 2008, 3 debates between McCain and Obama, the word poor or poverty did not come up 1 time in 3 presidential debates. Obama never raised it, McCain never raised it, the moderators never asked about it. 2 of those moderators, respectfully, are back this time on the stage. But look at the condition of the country where poverty is concerned and tell me how there can be any justification for how the issue of poverty doesn't get raised in these presidential debates, given now that 1 out of 2 Americans, that's 150 million of us, are either in or near poverty. Put another way, either you're in poverty or low income, which puts you just a paycheck or 2 or 1 catastrophe away from being in poverty. 150 million Americans wrestling with that issue. There's no way no reasonable or legitimate reason for not raising this issue in these presidential debates. Mr. Romney and Mr. Obama need to address the issue, need to tell us what they intend to do about it. Why? Because poverty is so extreme in our country now, it's threatening our very democracy. It's a matter of national security. These numbers are not sustainable. And so that's why we are on this poverty tour 2.0 in these four battleground states of Ohio, Virginia, Pennsylvania, the Keystone State, and of course we will wrap this tour in Florida. Doc, you want to offer some reflections before we get to these guests on what you've seen and heard in these first couple stops in Ohio and Virginia?
Well, I know that we have been inspired by the fight back among poor people and working people, that we are witnessing a kind of awakening that's taking place. And when Brother Tavis and I met 27 years ago, we made a covenant that we were trying to keep alive the legacy of Martin Luther King Jr. and Fannie Lou Hamer, Rabbi Abraham Joshua Heschel and Dorothy Day. And it's a tradition that says that a homeless brother or sister of whatever color has the same value and significance as a investment banker brother or sister of whatever color. And if you really believe that deep down in your soul, then you recognize that we live in a society with warped priorities, that we live in a system that is failing poor people and working people, that is not working for poor people and working people. And even though it may not be popular to raise these kinds of issues, we have to cut radically against the grain and especially transmit it to our younger generation. I would like us to actually give a applause for our young brothers and sisters up here on the balcony. It's so good to have the beautiful young folk here passing this tradition of struggle along.
Speaking of these young people, they are assembled here in the 10th Memorial Baptist Church. The pastor of this church is Reverend William B. Moore, and we are honored to have him with us today on this program. There are a number of other guests that we're going to talk to as well and introduce them as we move along. So we've got a few hours to wrestle with this issue from so many different perspectives.
Making money that we have now, and we had a whole lot more love. But then something happened as we went up the ladder, and as we went up the ladder, we did not take note of the fact that there were people who were slipping further and further into poverty. And so we have our eyes on the prize of those who are doing well, but not on those who are not doing so well. And we have lost the prophetic tradition of the prophet Amos, who said, "Let justice roll down like waters and righteousness like a mighty stream." We've lost what the master has said in Matthew chapter 25, that I was hungry and you didn't feed me. I was thirsty and you didn't give me water. I was outdoors and you didn't provide housing for me. We're so busy trying to get housing for ourselves that we've turned our backs on those who do not have. You are sitting in a community and in a church that have worked together to build a senior citizen home, to build 157 homes for first-time homeowners, the low and moderate income people just outside of the door, and 10 townhouses for first-time homeowners. And so we wanna talk the talk, but we don't wanna walk the walk. We're so busy preaching the gospel of prosperity that we don't wanna be prophets of those who are left back and who are locked out. Mm-hmm. We've lost that tradition.
Lord, that's powerful. It's Chamber of Commerce religion, market spirituality. But do you see, in fact, that a growing awareness in the churches for a move much more toward the prophetic as opposed to the more prosperity gospel peddlers?
I think it's all too slow. It's happening, but it's not happening fast enough. And I think that the media, in some ways or another, is shaping our values, and the media is not devoid of teaching and shaping values. That when we look on television, we see a church of hundreds and hundreds of thousands, but we're not reminded of the fact that the average size of the church in America is less than 100. And so we need to focus on not what we see on television, but what is happening right outside the doors of churches like 10th Memorial and the other church in the city that are, if they're not mega churches, they are mini churches. And there are more mini churches than there are mega churches, and we're closing our eyes to what is happening on the outside.
Let me ask you one or two other quick things before we let you go. Since you mentioned the notion of mega churches, and I want to be clear, I'm not casting aspersion or demonizing mega churches. I grew up in a small church in Indiana, one of those churches with 125 members. Kind of reminds me of this. My church was called New Bethel Tabernacle back in Kokomo, Indiana. So I grew up in a small church like this, but I go to a much larger church now, attend a much larger church in LA where I live. And so I long for those days of being in a church like this because I sit in a much larger church every Sunday now. But I want to ask you honestly, your sense of this move of the mega church to, as Dr. West would call it, the vanilla suburbs. What I love about 10th Memorial and churches like it is that they've made a decision to stay in the neighborhood. As you said, to build senior citizens' homes in the neighborhood, to build single family dwellings, first time home buyers in the city of Philadelphia. It's part of what's wrong with urban areas, and the reason why poverty runs amok in urban areas is that those of us who make it abandon those urban areas. And a lot of churches are going, these mega churches want to go way out to the vanilla suburbs and, you know, and abandon the inner city. So even if they are doing some work, you know, it's way out. You got to have, poor people don't often have transportation or the money for gas to get to. I know Negroes in LA right now, you know, who are making decisions on Sunday morning about going to church based on how much gas they have in their car to get to church on Sunday. So very quickly, what's your sense of this move by so many of our churches, since we're talking about the faith community, specifically black churches, to move away from the inner city, from the urban areas?
I think a couple of things are happening. God has blessed us to have a lot of trained clergy now. They're going to school, they're doing better. They're able to communicate the message of the gospel better. And as a result, their churches are growing in such a large way. And in order to accommodate the growth, and I'm not against mega churches because there are a lot of them who do a lot of good work, but when you are isolated from the community, sometimes you're isolated from the problem. And the prophet said, you know, I sat where they sat. When Pauline and I came to Philadelphia 38 years ago, we made a strategic decision to live in the community. We wanted to face the things that our people faced, and so we were here during the times of the drug dealings, the shootings, the riots, not riots, but a whole lot of other dysfunctional things that were going on. But we were able, I think, better to minister to people because we felt what they felt, we sat where they sat, and we did not do things just in a patronizing kind of way. I think that when you feel people's pain, you are motivated by that pain to help people in a genuine way, but not in a patronizing way, just because it's the nice thing to do, but it's the ought thing to do.
Well, as one who teaches at Union Theological Seminary in New York City, I lift your name as one who exemplifies the combination of humility, prophetic vision, love for the people, service at the center, and your pastorate as a calling rather than a career. That makes a difference.
Absolutely, and I think as a pastor, you know, that's certainly a lofty place, and it's a wonderful place to be. But it's also a place of awesome responsibility, and you cannot stand there without looking in the eyes and in the situations of every person who comes and worship in your church, and everybody who comes, because sometimes the parking lot don't always reflect the offering plate, but there are people who are in our congregations who don't have enough food to eat. In Philadelphia, they are part of that 32% that live below the poverty line. And you have to always be reminded that you pastor them too.
Speaking of pastoring them too, he's pastoring all of us today, and he's welcomed us into his home. Please thank Reverend William B. Moore and First Lady Pauline Moore, Reverend Tamika Moore, and the entire 10th and Moore Baptist Church family for having us here. So we've had a house band at every one of our stops on this tour, and since we're in a black church, we got a house band, if we can call it that today. So we're going to hear a little music while we reset this table and bring up some other guests. You're listening to the Poverty Tour 2.0 live from the 10th and Moore Baptist Church in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania.
Praise him, praise him, praise him, praise him, Jesus, blessed Savior, he's worthy to be praised. Oh, everybody praise him, oh, praise him, praise him. Praise him, Jesus, blessed Savior, he's worthy to be praised. Oh, from the rising of the sun unto the going down of the same, he's worthy. He's worthy to be praised. Oh, praise him. Oh, praise him. Praise him. Praise him. Jesus, blessed Savior, he's worthy.
And the church said, amen. Amen. Dr. West just leaned over. He said, we're going to need some more breaks in this program. Because we're going to want to hear some more of that.
Oh, that's true.
When you've been on the road like we've been on the road doing this work against all kind of forces, that stuff will lift you up.
Right.
Let's give them some love. The
give
praise
them
to
love.
The Lord.
It keeps us going. It keeps us going.
Yes, Lord. I feel like I'm in church now. We are delighted to be in Philadelphia. If you just tuned in, you're listening to the Poverty Tour 2.0. This is the third stop on a 4 swing state tour featuring Tavis Smiley and my abiding friend, Dr. Cornel West. Yes, sure. Sure, give Dr. West some love. I ain't got a problem with that. I love him too. We've been to Ohio and to Virginia, now in Pennsylvania, on our way to Florida. And we've been having some wonderful conversations about the issue of poverty in this country. I always look forward to, and as does Dr. West, of course, being a professor, I love engaging and talking with young people.
Oh, yes.
And there are a couple of young people we want to introduce now, one of them who is running for office, one of them who recently ran and won, one of them I know extremely, extremely well. I've known him since he was just a baby. And he was a young man when I met him many years ago in my foundation. I have a foundation. Had it for many, many years now that works with young people. And we do one thing, kind of like Kentucky Fried Chicken. We do one thing. We do it right. I only do one thing in my foundation is work with young people all across America by the thousands on developing their leadership potential. That's all we do is leadership development training. And I was delighted to have met this young man so many years ago. when he was in my foundation. Long story short, he was stellar. I could tell then he was going to make some significant contributions. He came back to Philadelphia with some other young people who were at that year's conference, and they started their own version of our foundation in the city of Philadelphia. And these 12, 13 years later, that organization, that foundation that they started here, young people, is still going very, very strong here in the city of Philadelphia. He has moved on to do other things. He went to college and got his undergraduate degree and got his master's degree and got married and was the youngest person in the history of Philadelphia to be the head of the youth commission for the city of Philadelphia. And then he ran for state representative, and now he's in the state house in Pennsylvania. Please welcome Jordan Harris. And we're also joined by a sister I've met just for the first time, but I want to hear more about her story. But she is a Democratic candidate for Pennsylvania's 16th Congressional District. We want to talk to young folk who are running for office and what they intend to do about these issues once they get there, because this issue is impacting their generation in ways that we can't even imagine. Every politician talks about passing on the deficit and passing on the debt and passing on a broken down America to the next generation. But let's talk now to some young folk about what they intend to do with these leadership positions. Please welcome Ariana Strader, running again for the 16th Congressional District here in Pennsylvania. So Jordan, let me start with you. First of all, it's good to see you. How is your wife?
She's doing well. She's doing well.
Tell her I said hello.
I definitely will.
All right. So how are things going now that you're on the inside? Since I've known you, you know, you've been an outsider. You've always been a young advocate, a youth activist. Now you're on the inside. Tell me that you ain't going to change now that you're on the inside, where these kinds of issues have always been so important to you.
Well, first, let me say thank you to you and Dr. West. As you said, I've known you forever, almost half my life. And I've been definitely blessed to receive personal mentorship from you. And I definitely appreciate that. And to the good doctor, I've sat at your feet and listened and learned. This man, in my opinion, is the Du Bois of our time, and probably the greatest public intellectual we have. So I come from good stock, as they say. I've been blessed to be around the both of you. No, not gonna change. And there's several reasons why. The first is, you know, my mama and my grandma still live in the community that I'll be representing on December 1st. So I can't change. Because my mother will call me, my grandmother will call me, and they will put me in check. That's the first thing. The second thing is that I won't change because I'm still here. Mm-hmm. And I think that's the beauty of my position now, is I'm still here. You know, I live on the same block that I did before I ran for office, and I don't plan on moving. Because the pain through poverty that many members of my community see, I can't serve them the best way I know how if I don't see it face to face. You know, when I see the young ones running up and down the street, and I understand that when they go to school, that the meals that they eat in school are probably the best meals that they will have, I can understand the poverty. You know, we have these things in Philadelphia we call play streets, where during the summertime, young people can go and get lunch and things of that nature. And to the average person, that might not make a difference. But when these young people go to school and that's the only meal that they have, those play streets where they get lunch is sometimes the only meal that they have. So for me, I can't change because I have to see it on a day-to-day basis. And I understand that even for me, a person like myself, you know, God forbid 2 years from now I run for re-election and I lose and I don't get a job, I'm close to poverty myself. And that's the reality. And I think we have to talk about it from that perspective, that, you know, although you may be making $80,000, $90,000, $100,000 today, you know, what happens in 2 years after you've lost that job and you've gone through your savings account? And PICO and PGW and the water department are calling you. Y'all don't know what I'm talking about. When every time you hear a truck, you go and peek through your window to make sure they're not coming to shut off your electricity. Oh, y'all want to act like we knew. But I know that feeling. So when you know that feeling and you stay in that environment, you can't change, because those are the things that are embedded in my mind to understand that, you know, poverty isn't just this state that is somebody's fault. And I think that's where we've gone. We've gone to a community, into a society where everybody who is in poverty, we look to blame them for their circumstances. But we don't look at all of the things that put them in their circumstance and blame the folks who had the reins when those things happened.
Since you mentioned this issue of food insecurity, Dr. West and I were raising this issue yesterday. The Agriculture Department just put a study out. So let me say first, it's not just about the official poverty numbers, they're bad enough. It's not just about the job numbers, they're bad enough. But by any objective standard, these reports keep coming out from everywhere, every day, about how bad our situation is. So the Agriculture Department put a study out the other day, you can find it online, that tonight in this country, the richest nation in the world, tonight, Jordan, 50 million Americans will go to bed not having enough to eat today. 50 million. Of that 50 million, 9 million are children. 50 million going to bed hungry, 9 million of them being children, enough to fill the states of California and Illinois. I live in LA, in California. So imagine that the entire state of California, where I'm from, and the entire state of Illinois, where the president is from, imagine that both of those states go to bed hungry tonight. That's a severe hunger problem. That's a severe issue of food insecurity. So it ain't just about watching these TV infomercials with kids in Africa with bloated bellies. You know, it's in this country that we have this issue of food insecurity. So I just wanted to just add that to what you were just saying as evidence of how serious this problem really is. What do you expect in the State House that you might be able to do? I mean, you're just one member and you're a freshman, so I'm gonna tell you now, you ain't gonna have a whole bunch of power when you walk in there. It ain't like running the youth commission in the city. You gotta start all over again, learn where the bathroom is and the legislative process. I know where your heart is, but what is it that you hope that you can do in the long run about issues like poverty and the ancillary issues connected to it?
Well, I think the first thing is tell the truth. I think, you know, it sounds so simple, but in our day and time, a lot of people just won't speak the truth. And the truth of the matter is, you talked about the Department of Agriculture, if I may for a second. You know, just earlier this year, the governor in Pennsylvania decided that it would be a good idea to put a food stamp access test on folks. Basically, this is what he first proposed, and he you know, wiggled around, and then it didn't happen, but he wanted to say if you had more than $2,000 in a checking savings account or in assets, more than $2,000 in assets, and you were receiving food stamps, that you should be cut off from the program. Now understand this. This is a program this is a test that he wanted to put on food stamps. One, that would cost the state of Pennsylvania money. Two, where food stamps aren't even paid for by the state of Pennsylvania. It's a federal program. So now what you see in halls of government across this country is you see people who are trying to basically assault poor people. It's an all-out assault on poor people. Because why would you want to institute something like this, this asset tax or test, when this money isn't even coming out of your budget, but you would have to spend money to put something like this in place? So you talk about the people already throughout the Commonwealth and throughout the country who are going to bed hungry. Well, what if that would have happened? How many more folks would have went to bed hungry? I get calls all the time about, you know, the food stamps that they get. We cut general assistance in the state of Pennsylvania on our last budget cycle. General assistance, small amount of money, is usually under $200. But for many folks, that was the money that they used to pay their rent. For many seniors who are in nursing homes, that was the money that they paid to the nursing home, for the rent for the nursing home. So what you have to understand is, for me, going in Harrisburg, maybe not having a lot of power as a freshman, I have two things. I have a heart and I have a mouth. And as long as my heart tells me it's the right thing to do and my mouth can articulate the words, we're gonna speak and put truth to power, because it has always been that truth-telling that has brought us through as a nation. Whether it was that we were in chains, whether it was that we were out of chains but still oppressed, as long as we spoke the truth and took truth to power, we were able to mobilize and move forward, and that's what we have to continue to do.
That's Jordan Harris showing some love. We're gonna take a quick break. The thing about these radio programs is you have breaks you have to take. We're gonna take a quick break for just a minute or so, and we will come right back and continue this conversation with Jordan Harris and be joined by Ariana Strader, who's a Democratic candidate for Pennsylvania's 16th Congressional District. You're listening to the Poverty Tour 2.0 on Pacifica and Native One.
Brother George. Strong, Brother George. Strong, strong, strong.
Yes, 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 yes. We're back, Poverty Tour 2.0. We've just heard from the eloquent Brother Jordan, Representative Harris, and we move now to our dear sister Ariana.
Hello.
Would you like first to share your story?
Sure.
And two, would you like to highlight what do you perceive to be the challenges for shattering the sleepwalking that's so prevalent?
Absolutely. So, Ariana Strader, and I am the youngest of 10 kids. My mother, a waitress. So she would often work 3 waitressing jobs just to put a roof over our heads.
Mm.
If it weren't for food stamps or the National Free Lunch Program or even the Pell Grant, I wouldn't be where I am today, running for office. Mm. I feel fortunate. You know, I worked really hard. I joined the military 2 months after 9/11. I enlisted in the United States Army as an E-1. I didn't have a college education, but the Army said they'd put a roof over my head, give me 3 squares a day, and access to an education when I got out. This was a good decision for me so that I could, hopefully break that cycle of poverty in my life. And it allowed me to. When I left the military, I got my bachelor's degree in business and I got my master's degree in project management. And I've worked very, very hard. I'm now a mom of 2 amazing kids. My husband's in the back over here. And I'm a very fortunate woman. But if it weren't for these programs, I wouldn't be sitting at this table. And I think that it needs to become a priority so that there are other young people in this country that can do the same things that I have done. Without having to enlist in the military or without having to take on massive student loan debt just to get an education.
Mm-hmm. Well, why do you think that there has not been a wider expression of moral outrage in the community in general, but especially among young people, given the dire circumstances? We got the prison industrial complex, you got disgraceful schools, dilapidated housing. You would think there would be movement of a much stronger fight back. What do you think is standing in the way of that kind?
You know, I don't know what's standing in the way because I feel outrage. I feel inspired. I feel like I have to do something. And I know the people that I speak to, they feel the same way. I mean, we wouldn't see things like the Occupy movement happen if people weren't outraged. I think that we can do a better job, and I think it's a matter of having discussions like this and continuing the discussion when we leave here to help continue that inspiration. But I don't know why we don't see more of it, because I definitely believe that it's something everyone is dealing with every day. I mean, my sister, who lives in California, she posted on Facebook the other day. She said, some people laugh all the way to the bank. Some people laugh all the way to the food bank. That's where I'm heading today. My sister. So poverty hasn't left my family. I am 1 of 10 that was able to escape.
You're the youngest of 10. I'm the eldest of 10. So we have something in common here. I'm delighted that you're running for office, and I appreciate your sensibilities born of your background. Let me ask, though, why it is that you think that that elective office is a good place to make a difference. And I ask that with this in mind, I believe that public service is a noble profession. So I'm glad you're running. We need more people like you in Washington. So it's a beautiful thing. But there are a lot of people who believe, and I think rightly so, that our body politic, our system of governance is so dysfunctional. I had a long talk with Jordan about this when he told me he wanted to run. And I asked him this very question. Of course, for him, he got a chance to answer it privately. You got to answer it publicly. But since you're running for public office at the congressional level, what is it that you think you can accomplish inside a system that people see as broken, where both parties are bought and bossed by big banks, big money, big business? How do you see yourself operating inside that kind of system?
Well, first, I think we have to change that system. Right? We've got to take that money out of politics because that is what is degrading the way that our politics is running right now. I am a single person. I can't do it alone. But if we continue to elect people that are there to support and be of the people, we can change the way Washington works. It starts with one. We see, and hopefully that's me. Hopefully I can make that change. I'm a strong woman. I've got a loud voice. As the youngest of 10, I know how to be heard. And I know that it's going to take a lot of hard work, but that's not something I'm scared of. And I think that the more people we elect that have this perspective, that understand what it's like to struggle, that know that we need to get the corporate money and the corporate interest out of politics so that we can actually have a government that works for us, that we can change the way Washington works.
Well, before I go back to Jordan with some additional questions, there's a microphone here to my left. In this segment, we're going to have time for probably just three questions or three comments. So if there are three people, we're going to do this every hour, but if there are three people that have a question or comment about something they've heard so far, feel free to step this microphone while I'm talking to Jordan Harris. There's a microphone right here to my left. If you have a question or comment, we'll take the first three people that line up at this microphone here in the aisle to my left. Jordan, Ariana made a comment about being the youngest of 10 kids. And I'm sensitive to her situation because, again, I grew up in that same kind of poor environment with nine brothers and sisters. Here's the reality in America today. The younger you are, the more likely you are to be in poverty. In the richest nation in the world, the younger you are, the more likely you are to be in poverty. You were the youngest person in the history of the city. I believe my facts are correct to run the Youth Commission, and you give me the official title of that organization that runs out of the mayor's office here. But what do you say to, what do you say about the fact that the younger you are in Philadelphia, the younger you are in Pennsylvania, the younger you are in America, the more likely you are to be poor, so that you end up really surrendering your life's choices before you ever know your life's chances? That's kind of how it works for young people in America today.
Well, the first thing is I was trumped. The person who took the job after me was actually younger than me.
All right, so you did have the record.
I did have,
okay.
Know, but strong sister, Jamira from the city of Philadelphia, kind of trumped me. But you know, the interesting thing about it is, for me, I think, and we've had this conversation about, you know, my generation kind of being one of the first generations outside of the civil rights movement, the civil rights struggle. So I think one of the things that we're seeing is that we're seeing generations of poverty, and you're seeing young people in my generation who are two and three and four generations deep into it. So poverty is all they have ever known. So you got young people who grow up not having, who adapt to not having, who begin to raise children who don't have. And that's just the lifestyle that they live. And the sad thing about it is that we become accustomed to it so much that we no longer fight against it. Because we believe this is who we are, this is the circumstances, this was the hand that was dealt to me, so this is just how I'm supposed to live. And the sad thing is it doesn't get better with a college degree nowadays. Because nowadays you go and you get a college degree. My mother told me, look, all you have to do, and I will be happy, is grow up, go to school, get a college education, and get a job, and everything will be fine. I love my mama, but we need to have a conversation.
Yeah, yeah.
Because that's just not the truth anymore.
Right.
You know, but this point that our dear brother William, Pastor Moore made about more love in the past. He grew up in poverty, but there was more love. Mm-hmm. where is that love in the younger generation? In the rule of money, without integrity, you don't learn how to fight for justice. You're just up for sale. Mm. And so the young people, even their conception of success is just to sell out for the highest bidder. Then they get more money, more title, but their souls are empty. And if your soul is empty, you can't fight for justice. You see, our dear brother grew up in poverty, still fighting for justice after now, what, 30, 40 years. Something went into the shaping of his soul. He learned how to love, and when you learn how to love, you learn how to fight for justice. That's a spiritual question. Mm-hmm. It's a moral question. You see it in the bubblegum music of too much of the young people, as opposed to the real thing that we're hearing today. How do y'all deal with that?
Well, I think, Dr. West, I think you bring a good point about the, mm-hmm. about the love. I think, but also you got to understand is that many of our young people don't know love because they've never been shown the love themselves.
Yeah. That's right. That's what I'm talking about.
So while we do have young people throughout this great nation who will not stand on the sidelines and watch as their future go to waste, and they do continue to fight, I think what you also see is that many of our young people just want love.
Yes.
So if I grew up in a society where I never had and I've never known to have,
yes.
but then all of a sudden somebody gives something to me that I've never seen before, and this article, this item is something that people have been telling me forever is a sign of success, regardless of what the cost is to me,
that's
if
right.
they're willing to give, I want to take.
Yes.
I want to take because I've never had it, I've never seen it, I've never touched it, but you as a society have told me that this is what success means. That nice shiny car outside of the house is what success means. So forget the fact that you're living in public housing. The fact that you have that nice shiny car means that you're success. And because of the success, now I'm supposed to get all of this love and admiration from all of the people that I grew up who want to now be just like me. Because I haven't myself been shown that love. So now I want this superficial love that is being shown to me because of these things that I have. And I think that's the yes. difference, is that many of our young people haven't been shown that love. And I don't. And here's the thing. I'm not necessarily gonna knock some of the parents, because many times many of them didn't have time to show the child love because they were working three jobs trying to put food on the table because there was a lack in the household. So my brother, it is not an easy. It is not an easy problem to fix. It's a lot going on. But I agree with you.
Yes.
At the source of all of our struggle and all of our pain, we fought because we had that love.
This is what the Tavis Smiley Foundation produces. I'm just saying. I'm just saying.
Strong brother.
I'm just saying. Quick question, quick comment. We're going to squeeze three in before we wrap this segment. Yes, ma'am.
Good morning. I found out in Philadelphia, poverty, If you are poor, you get all federal funds. But it doesn't help the poor. It just keeps, they divert it to other programs. It's been so many billions of dollars here, mm-hmm. but it never goes to help the people. And welfare was created to supposed to be a mechanism that you go in and out. I've had a tenant for 18 years. She grew up her children in public housing, and they're grown and they're graduated from school. But she's not my tenant anymore because she moved, living with the water bill. But they tend to let the whole family generate over 50 years. There's no program to let you go through. So welfare and poverty is, they need the state of poverty, and so they can get the money and not do anything with it.
Let me thank you for your comment. Ariana, let me come to you because her first issue I want you to address very quickly. Yeah. Because there are people who have concerns about who will take over in Washington in January, and that's what you're running for a congressional seat. Because whoever, depending on who takes over, there are going to be more block grants to states. There is one particular party that loves unfunded mandates, that loves block grants, loves sending stuff to states and letting the states decide. We're back to states' rights again, letting the states decide how they want to spend that money. She raises this point, so that the money that is meant to be for poor people, the money that's meant to be for children, they send that money to the states, and the states get a chance to decide how that money is going to be spent. You know where I'm going with this. Your thoughts about that?
Well, you know, here in Pennsylvania, if that were to occur, Governor Corbett would not be giving it to the people that need it the most. Mm-hmm. And I think that what needs to happen, you know, to manage this is we need to have a livable wage in this country. Yeah. Minimum wage is too low. Yeah. We could bring people out of poverty. We could help people in our communities. If they could earn a livable wage, they would not need food stamps. They would not need these public assistance programs because they could provide on their wage that they would get from their job.
And I think it's very important to keep in mind, anytime you talk about welfare, you have to begin by talking about those at the top. There's no way you're going to get these beautiful buildings in downtown Philadelphia without tax breaks, without subsidies. And when they really get in trouble, as you saw with the investment banks, what did they get? Bailouts. And they got bailouts in the form of trillions of dollars. And they can go get interest-free loans from the Fed. Wouldn't it be nice if our students could get interest-free loans when they go to college? So when you talk about welfare, first start at the top, and then poor people organizing, and the elderly, because we cut the poverty of the elderly in half in the 60s because of Medicare. That was crucial. But when it comes to poor people, then all of a sudden poor people are being viewed as dependent. Poor people are being viewed as getting a handout. When the thing, it's been going on for a long time. We just don't talk about it publicly, honestly, candidly. This is what I mean by a system that is failing, a system that needs to be changed. Thank God for these two young folk trying to do that. I know you got a question, my brother.
How you doing? My name is Emmanuel Evans, and I was wondering, why is it so hard to push the agenda for them to talk about poverty, but the moderators is in control of it? Who is controlling them to put that on the table? Both, I haven't heard it from neither one of the parties, and I'm figuring at this time, poverty is the big thing in America, because it seems to me they're trying to downsize America, a way of life. Our quality of life is being downsized because they're taking everything that's been put in place to make it convenient for us, they're taking away. Yeah. So how is people supposed to survive, and who do we push, who do we go to, who is the monster that we have to see to make this happen?
That's a powerful question. Let me just answer that with a couple of different answers. Let me tell you three things to answer this question. Number one, you will find this interesting, I think. The New York Times, on their search engine, you can go see this for yourself, did the research on with their word search engine on the Democratic and Republican conventions. The Democrats, his question was, how do we get this issue on the agenda? And why doesn't the media address this issue? The Democrats in Charlotte use the word poor or poverty. They uttered the word from the convention stage, poor or poverty, three times for every 25,000 words. The Democrats said the word poor poverty three times for every 25,000 words uttered. Care to guess how many times the Republicans said it? It's going to shock you. The Republicans used the word poor or poverty five times for every 25,000 words. Now, let me add very quickly. Lip service is just that, lip service. But the fact that the Republicans mention poverty, mention the poor more times than the Democrats did ought to tell you something about why we can't get a real conversation about it, even by a party that says and has proven over the years, Lyndon Johnson was a Democrat, best president on poverty. So Democrats care about the issue, but they didn't put that issue front and center when they had the attention of the nation. Bill Clinton, you know, the three out of three times for every 25,000 words, it disproportionately went to Clinton because he used those words 11 times in his speech. Of course, he talked 2 hours longer than everybody else, didn't he? So he had more time to get it out. But Bill Clinton is the primary reason the number was as high as it was because he used it 11 times. My point is that the Republicans nor the Democrats really said much about poverty. Mr. Ryan mentioned it. Mr. Obama mentioned it. Mr. Romney mentioned it. Mr. Biden mentioned it. But there was no real platform for discussion about this. I'm going to tell you something else, number two, about why it doesn't get discussed. We love Barack Obama in this community. He won this, President Obama. He won in this community. So you obviously supported him. You precinct for him. You walked precincts for him. You campaigned for him. You raised money for him. You voted for him. Dr. West did 65 different dates. He was an Obama surrogate during the campaign and did 65 different days to get Barack Obama elected president of the United States. Doc and I have said everywhere, and we're going to say it again, I'm sure many times today, that we believe, no doubt in our minds, we said it on national TV, on O'Reilly last night, on the right, on Fox, this morning on Morning Joe, on MSNBC, on the left, we say it everywhere. There's no doubt in our mind that Obama is infinitely better than Mitt Romney in this election. So that's not even the issue. You said that. That's not the question for us. But when Barack Obama, as senator, ran for president 4 years ago, he ran on a platform saying that he, these are his words, not mine, saying that he was going to fight to eradicate poverty in America. That's what he said. He hadn't quite gotten around to that yet. He said that he was going to fight to raise the minimum wage to $9.50 an hour. Hadn't quite got around to that yet. Now, lest you perceive this, as so many people do, as hating on the president, we're talking here about accountability. I'm answering the brother's question, how do you get poverty on the agenda? And sometimes you have to fight with your friends. Sometimes you got to fight with your friends to push that issue out there. So one, we got to get the candidates to address the issue. If the candidates address the issue, the media will have to address the issue because the media is covering the horse race. So if Romney and Obama are debating the issue and talking about it every day, the media is going to have to cover it. That's one way to get at it. Mm-hmm. The second way to get at it is for the media to talk about it and make them talk about it. So they can force the media to cover it, or the media can force them to talk about it. How do you do that? You demand that Jim Lehrer, that Bob Schieffer, that Martha Raddatz and Candy Crowley, the four American journalists who are moderating these upcoming debates, you demand that they put this issue on the agenda for the upcoming presidential debates. So we can see where they stand, what the similarities or the contrasts are about how they're gonna fight the issue of poverty. I told you a few minutes ago, four years ago, it didn't even come up. So if the media doesn't raise it and the candidates don't talk about it, and there are only two of us, you know, running around the country like we don't have jobs. We're not getting paid for this. We gave two lectures on this tour. We gave a lecture in Ohio at Cuyahoga Community College. We gave a lecture last night at Delaware State. I'm gonna keep it real with you. The two lectures that we gave is how we raised the money to pay for this tour, along with people like 10th and More Baptist Church who didn't charge us to come in. So we're not getting paid to do this, and we both got to go back to work on Monday. After running around the country, just trying to ring the bell and beat the drum, we got to go back to work. So the media has to raise this issue. The candidates have to raise this issue. That's how you get the issue out. Now, neither one of them is going to do that. Neither entity, the candidates, the body politic, or the media will raise the issue if we, the people, don't push and demand and show up at town halls and use radio and the internet, use every tool available to us to force both of them, politicians and the media, to address the issue. I cut you off, you were gonna say
no,
something.
No, I was just gonna add one thing. Yesterday was his birthday too, so he was in four cities on his birthday. Four different cities on his birthday, it was beautiful. We still celebrated though, Turned on a little Luther and some Aretha to keep make sure his spirits were up. But the other possibility, and it goes hand in hand with working within the system, and this is especially true for black people who have been dealing with an American system that rarely treated us as human beings, from slavery to Jim Crow to American terrorism, traumatizing and terrorizing us. Our other option is bearing witness out of love and justice, hitting the streets organized and going to jail if necessary, and in fact, being willing to die. Part of the problem is that we don't have enough people who love people enough that they're willing to fight and die for them. That's a fundamental difference in the leadership in the 1960s and leadership today. Today, leadership is often perceived as being successful, and you end up well-adjusted to injustice. And if you're well-adjusted to injustice, you're not going to fight and die for nothing other than you and your mama. And I love my mama too. But poor children are our children. I don't care what color, I'm a Christian. But at least we ought to start on the chocolate side of town with them. And poor children need to know somebody loves them enough to fight for them and die for them. And not isolated individuals. It's got to be organized people that say, we care for you. And you know why? Because folk before cared for us.
I hear the music. I want to say goodbye to Jordan and Ariana. I promise I will start the next hour with your question. You just take a seat 1 second. I promise I'll come right back to you. I'm sorry about that. We ran out of time in this hour. Jordan, 15 seconds, last comment, then Ariana.
I think the next thing that we have to do, agreeing with both of you, is that we cannot allow the Republican Party to paint a picture of poverty being poor people sitting at home collecting checks. That's we right. also have That's to talk right. about this oxymoronic term called working poor,
That's
where
right.
people go to work every single day and they still can't That's make right. ends meet.
That's Jordan Harris. Ariana, last word.
Right here in the 16th Congressional District, Reading was named the poorest city in the country. Yet we've got a representative that is not representing them. And I want to go to Washington so that I can represent all people. And I appreciate the opportunity to come here and speak and have this conversation with you.
She's running for the 16th Congressional District. She's a Democrat named Ariana Strader. Please thank her. Please thank Ariana and Jordan for being with us on this program today. Please thank them for coming today. You're listening to the Poverty Tour 2.0, brought to you by Pacifica and Native Voice One.
How great is our God? Sing with me, how great is our God? Oh, we'll see how great is our God. Oh, how great is our God. Sing with me, how great is our God. Oh, see how great is our God. How great thou art.
them some love. Give them some love. The praise team sounding good. I'm Tavis Smiley.
I'm Cornel West.
This is the Poverty Tour 2.0. We are live in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, the city of brotherly love and sisterly affection, for the third stop on our four swing state poverty tour. So far, already in Ohio, in Virginia, today in Pennsylvania, and then on to Florida, in case you're just tuning in. We are out around the country trying to get the issue of poverty pushed higher on the American agenda. You may have been reading in your local newspapers over the last few days about the abysmal job numbers and the dismal poverty numbers. You put those two numbers together along with numbers about food insecurity and children falling into poverty. There's a report that came out the other day from a foundation called Capital Kids, capital as in the nation's capital, Capital Kids, and their report found, you can go online and read it, that childhood poverty, listen to this, childhood poverty in the nation's capital is higher than in Mexico. Childhood poverty in the capital of the richest nation in the world, according to research from Capital Kids, childhood poverty in Washington, D.C. is greater than in Mexico. And yet there are so many Americans who still want to preach this notion of American exceptionalism, as if somehow these issues just really don't exist. I promised a brother in the last hour, we'd start this hour out with his question. If he's not here, I promise I'll come back to him a little bit later. Just, oh, he's over there now. Hold on that. When I come to questions, we'll get to you, I promise you. So just don't leave the room. But when we get to questions in this hour, you will lead, be the first person in line. So we're on this tour, and we're at the 10th Memorial Baptist Church. Please thank Reverend William B. Moore once again and First Lady Pauline Moore for having us here and the wonderful church family here at 10th Memorial Baptist Church in Philadelphia for hosting us today on this stop on the tour. So, Doc, as you know, in every one of these stops, we have not had one conversation in these town halls where we don't have a couple of segments dedicated to just talking about solutions.
Absolutely, because not only are we talking about solutions, but we need hope. We've got to have hope, but we don't want any cheap optimism. We are blues people, tied to the gospel. The blues not about optimism. Been down so long, it don't worry me no more. That's why I keep keeping on. Curtis Mayfield, keep on pushing. That's not an optimistic claim. That's about hope. How do you keep persisting, prevailing, persevering? And when we look in the eyes of these young folk, we see hope. And that's why we're talking about solutions tied to hope and struggle.
So now we'll talk about solutions with a wonderful roundtable of, again, young people. And so that's an honor for us to have so many young people on this time. We've talked to young folk all around the tour, but when I saw the list of our producer, the list of our producer, Jay-Z, no, not that Jay-Z, we have our own Jay-Z, and he's white, he ain't even black.
There he is right there, there he is he's right there. Get that brother a hand, get brother Jay-Z
brother,
a hand.
Honorary brother.
Get brother Jay-Z a hand.
When we saw the list of confirmed participants for the Philadelphia stop on the town hall tour, I knew many of the names, I knew the work that many of these people do, and I was so delighted to see that on this stop, we have a much higher percentage of young persons who are involved in solutions than any other city. And that's a testament and a tribute to Philadelphia. So in the last hour, we talked to two young persons, one running for office at the congressional level, one about to go at the state level to the House of Representatives here in Philadelphia, or in the state of Pennsylvania, I should say. And so now we're pleased to be joined by three others who are working on solutions in their own right. In no particular order, let me first introduce Vanessa Graber, who's with the Prometheus Radio Project. We'll explain what that is in a moment. Please welcome Vanessa. From the Philadelphia Student Union, please welcome Azeem Hill. And last but not least, an organization that any one of us who pays attention to politics in this country, to democratic politics, small d, you know this group. Please welcome from the Color of Change, Rashad Robinson. Rashad, I suspect across the nation, the work of Color of Change is best known, at least with regard to this panel. But for those who don't know about Color of Change, tell us about the work that you have done, and just remind us, you know, ask you to put your brag hat on just for a second. Just brag a little bit about some of the things that you all have been involved in over the years in terms of activism that this audience might not know that you guys were behind it, but they heard about this campaign. They heard about that campaign. So tell us first about what Color of Change does and some of the issues you've been working on, then we'll come to Poverty Expressly.
Great. Color of Change is the largest online black political organization. We have about 900,000 members around the country, and every single day we take on issues, in fact, impacting black folks and their allies of all races. We were founded right after Katrina in the aftermath when people were donating money, figuring out what they could do. People were horrified by what was happening in the Gulf Coast. There were activists who were looking at the abject failure of our political system to adequately take care of and be accountable for what was happening in the Gulf Coast. So Color of Change was really born as an accountability vehicle to hold corporations and the government and political leaders accountable for how they serve and deal with black America. And you know, as a result, you know, over the last 7 years, we've taken on a variety of campaigns, from fighting for justice for the Gina 6 kids, and we led that effort, raising over $250,000 online for their legal defense, mobilizing tens of thousands of people to go down and rally in Gina, Louisiana, and to the governor. Back a number of years ago when Glenn Beck went on the air and called President Obama a racist with a deep-seated hatred for white folks, Color of Change led a two-year campaign that mobilized over 285,000 members to get over 200 sponsors to leave Fox News and the Glenn Beck Show. Sending a message that race baiting is not going to be a profitable sport. So the last episode of the Glenn Beck Show, it was that company that you put a goal in an envelope and they send it in and they melt it down and send you back cash. It wasn't Honda or Toyota or McDonald's advertising on the Beck Show. And over the last couple of years, we've mobilized hundreds of thousands of people to fight for justice for Troy Davis, to fight for justice for Trayvon Martin, and we've been leading a campaign against the American Legislative Exchange Council, also known as ALEC. ALEC is a 40-year-old right-wing organization that's sort of the epitome of the problem with money and politics in this country. They craft what they call model legislation, which is these pieces of bills that they craft behind closed doors where corporations and state legislators go into rooms. They write legislation that we know hurts our communities. Everything from crafting the voter ID bills that have went around the country, including in this state. They wrote the Stand Your Ground law along with Walmart that became famous in the Trayvon Martin tragedy. They wrote the Arizona immigration bill. They've written laws to decimate public education and a variety of other things that hurt our community. We've been leading a campaign over the last 8 months to take on ALEC and been successful in getting nearly 40 major corporations from Walmart, Johnson & Johnson, Coca-Cola, and McDonald's to leave the American Legislative Exchange Council, sending a message to those corporations that they can't come for black folks' money by day and try to take away our vote by night, and sending a message to ALEC that they can't have business as usual when there's a vehicle of everyday people's voices that will hold them accountable.
Please, give a shout some love. I wanted to start with that so folk, again, could understand what the organization is and what it does, and I knew that once you laid out some of the campaigns you were involved in, for those who might not have heard of the organization online, you've heard of the work that this organization has done online, which leads me to the question I really wanted to get to now that we've gotten past the preamble, which is what can be done to mobilize social media? Because this is really what makes this work so powerful. Can you imagine, Dr. West and I were discussing this on the bus not long ago, can you imagine with all that he did get accomplished, can you imagine what Dr. King could have done if he'd had Twitter and Facebook and MySpace and for all that he did get done, can you imagine how much more he could have accomplished if he'd had the tool of social media available to him? So given, Rashad, that poverty is, Dr. West and I believe at least, given that poverty is the moral and the spiritual issue of our time, given that poverty is threatening our very democracy, imagine for me a world in which social media could be used like it was used in Egypt, mm-hmm. like it was used in Iran, mm-hmm. in other places around the globe. Poor people, at the very least, have access to a cell phone. Everybody I don't care how broke you are. Most everybody has a cell phone. I don't know how they do it, but people figure out a way to get a cell phone. They ain't got food to eat. They got holes in their shoes. Rent ain't paid, but they on that cell phone. Somebody say amen. I'm just keeping it real. So since everybody has access to social media, imagine a world for me in which we activate social media to tackle the issue of poverty and to push leaders to make it a priority. How might that work?
You know, at Color of Change, you know, we believe our theory of change is one where every single day we're hit with all sorts of information. The news, the newspaper, billboards, and sometimes it makes us upset, sometimes it makes us angry, sometimes it makes us happy and joyful. But what we try to do is we pair that information with something to do instantly, giving people a clear sort of ability to take action in that moment before they go back to doing what they were doing before. And we've talked about the wide range of the issues that people are facing, from trying to get food on their table to making sure their kids have a safe place to go. And so we want to be able to kind of provide folks the ability to instantly take action. And so we believe that these tools actually do that. But you know, what Dr. King had and what other great activists and movements had was a clear theory of change. And so we don't believe you just take Twitter or you take Facebook or you take online tools and you put it on a bad strategy. You have to have a solid strategy that's really clear, that gives people something clear to do, that points them at the clear villain, and gives them the ability to hold those folks accountable. And folks in power are not going to cede power, right? And so at Color of Change, we've taken on both political parties. We've taken on the administration at times, and we continue to hold the Republicans right now accountable for the race baiting in this election and the ways in which they're trying to suppress our votes around the country. But for us at Color of Change, we believe that building a powerful movement with everyday people's voices is just part of it, that you need clear strategic insight, that you need to be able to leverage and use the media and hold them accountable when they do not tell the story accurately. And then we need to tell our stories. We need to be able to elevate the voices of everyday people, tell positive narratives, tell narratives that connect with other communities and other folks, and build a movement that's big, authentic, and representative of the real challenges that we have to face.
Indeed, indeed. Powerful. Our dear sister Vanessa, radio plays a very important role when we talk about media. And when you think about radio these days, at least myself, I tend to think of the big corporations that control now so many of our radios. When I was growing up, we used to have independent radio operators. Could choose their own records, have their own news. Now you get this homogenizing. Even the music, these 7-Eleven songs with seven words played 11 times. I mean, I can't take that. I like stories, you know what I mean? I like narratives. You part of Prometheus Radio Project. Tell us about the project and how do you all intervene in this situation?
Well, access to media is still a really big problem in this country, and the Prometheus Radio Project formed in the late 90s in response to the 1996 Telecommunications Act. There was a huge consolidation of media ownership, and what happened was a lot of big media companies such as Clear Channel, Viacom, Time Warner, they started buying up television stations, radio stations, newspapers, and the outcome was the homogenization of our media. What we also saw was a huge decline in minority and women ownership of media. So a group of pirate radio activists came together across the country. It started out in the Bay Area, but it spread quickly throughout the country. And they threatened the FCC to start operating more pirate stations if the FCC didn't license non-commercial radio stations. The FCC is the Federal Communications Commission. They're, of course, the governing body who regulates all media and telecommunications in this country. They weren't interested in licensing more non-commercial media. So it took a real grassroots movement from organizers, from pirate radio pirates, all kinds of people representing different social movements to really place a lot of pressure on them to do so. In 2000, they licensed the first low-power FM radio stations. And low-power FM stations are small 100-watt stations that are non-commercial, and they serve communities. And we saw over 860 stations licensed all over the country. That quickly ended with pressure from big broadcasters who petitioned the FCC to end this practice due to their bogus claims of interference. We, of course, knew that was not true. So we petitioned the FCC again, applying public pressure with another campaign to get them to license or to commission a study about interference. And the MITRE Corporation found in their study that these little low-power stations actually didn't cause the same level of interference that the big broadcasters claimed. And so we thought around that time, 2002, okay, they're gonna license more radio stations. However, it took a 10-year battle on the part of Prometheus and a lot of our partners who are media reform organizations and organizations like Color of Change to start a grassroots movement for media justice to pass what's called the Local Community Radio Act. This piece of legislation is the first media reform legislation that was successfully passed in 2010 and signed last year by President Obama. And this mandates the FCC to open up the airwaves, which of course are owned by the public, to license more non-commercial radio stations. So we've been engaged in a campaign since that legislation has been passed to, well, bring this message all over the country. We've also been going on tour, going into lots of communities, and getting the word out because this is a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity to democratize the airwaves and take these stations back from corporations. Yeah, we need these stations more than ever. We're on the heels of this election that's not being covered in the way that it should. We have a growing movement for social and economic justice that's global. You know, we don't see our people represented in the media. And so the work of Prometheus is to use radio as a tool for social justice and to get more people representing their voice on the airwaves.
Before we have to take a break here, a short break in 3 minutes, let me ask you, I obviously get this because I do this every day, but for those who might not understand how this works or understand what the link is, when you say democratize the airwaves, unpack that for me, because I want people to understand what the link is between what Prometheus is doing and an agenda that will empower poor people with information. I believe that information is power, that knowledge is power. And if you're only getting, if you're only hearing from one source, if there are only two or three big companies that own all the media outlets in the country, then you know what they're delivering. So I want you to make quickly for me in 2 minutes the link between what Prometheus is doing and how that impacts the lives of poor people, those who are disenfranchised politically, economically, socially, by having access to hearing what they need to hear about what's really happening in this country.
So there's a lot of different kinds of media. What they're referring to mostly in their critique of the media is the mainstream media, owned by mostly corporations and other business commercial interests. The kind of media that we're talking about is independent community media. It's participatory in nature. That means you can go to one of these radio stations or a public access television station or a community newspaper and you can volunteer, you can get training, you can get a show, you can write a story, you can advocate for your issue and give voice to your social movement. And that's what's missing from the media landscape in this country. And those are the kinds of stations that Prometheus is interested in building.
Thank you. That's Vanessa Graber. You've already heard now from Rashad Robinson from Color of Change. We've yet to talk to Azeem Hill, but we're going to continue this conversation with Azeem from the Philadelphia Student Union and others and get your questions and comments involved in this second hour of 3 hours live from the 10th Memorial Baptist Church in Philadelphia. This is Stop 3 on the Poverty Tour 2.0, brought to you by Pacifica and Native Voice One. Thank you. Welcome back to the Poverty Tour 2.0, live in Philadelphia at the 10th Memorial Baptist Church, stop three on our four-state poverty tour, Ohio, Virginia, Pennsylvania, and Florida. Today finds us in the city of brotherly love, talking about how to make poverty a priority in this country. We were just talking before the break about social media, and we're going to talk more about it in just a second here. But for those of you who have social media devices, feel free to pull them out right now and tweet or text family and friends to watch this stream live right now on povertytour.smileyandwest.com. 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 If you want to tweet or text people, they can watch this live feed on Ustream even as we speak. So we were talking, Doc, before the break to Brother Rashad and Sister Vanessa. But now I want to get to Azeem Hill, who's with the Philadelphia Student Union. So Azeem, welcome to the program. Thanks for your patience. And before I get to Azeem, let me just say in this segment, we're going to have time for a few questions. So that brother, who I promised to start with, come on back over here now, because in just a few minutes, we'll get back to another section of questions. And if we can get another, at least three or four people who have questions or comments about anything at this microphone behind this first brother, we will get to a few questions more from the audience, three or four people in this segment, or in this hour, I should say. So, Azeem, tell me about the Philadelphia Student Union, what it is, and what you all are doing, and why it connects, how it connects to the issue of poverty, which we're discussing today.
Okay. First, I want to say thank you for having me. Well, before I start, how many of you have ever heard poverty is the way out? Has anybody heard that before in school, poverty is the way out? I mean, I'm sorry, education is the way out of poverty.
There you go. Yeah, yes, I've heard the latter. I've heard the latter, yes.
So education being the way out of poverty.
Absolutely, yes sir, yes sir.
So I went to West Philadelphia High School. During my experience at West Philadelphia High School, I signed on to the Philadelphia Student Union. The Philadelphia Student Union is a grassroots, youth-led empowerment and organizing group to fight. What we do is we organize students to fight for a more quality education that engages all students in Philadelphia. I'm going to talk about what's happening to Philly public schools, what trends students see and organizations see, and what we're doing to fight for a solution, what the community is doing. It's no secret that for decades, public education has been underfunded. It's been keeping poor people poor, uneducated, and silenced. There's been many attempts to fix or reform education, but the problem is that reform has been being led by the wrong people. Recently, the newest wave of reform in Philadelphia is being pushed by the Boston Consulting Group. They call themselves the quote-unquote leading advisor on business strategy. So they created a plan to close down 40 public schools and create so-called quote-unquote achievement networks and hand over schools to education management organizations and charter organizations. What we understand as students is that that's not an educational model, it's a business model. Mm-hmm. Thank you. There's no data that shows their strategy will improve the educational and learning experience and help students build pathways to success. There is data that does show massive school closings disproportionately hold back African American students and people of color and poor people. After over a decade of failed reforms and, oh, I'm sorry. After over a decade of failed reforms, the Philadelphia Student Union, Youth United for Change, Action United, the Philadelphia Federation of Teachers, and the Philadelphia Federation of Teachers have come together to form PCAPS, Philly Coalition Advocating for Public Schools. This fall, thousands of Philly parents, teachers, and students are mobilizing and organizing to stand up and create an alternative plan that will not prioritize closing schools down or letting them be run by corporations. This plan will make schools places students want to go, a place teachers want to teach in, and a place that gives parents power and the ability to make sure their child is getting a quality learning experience. What we're going to do first is listen to all levels of the community, because we understand the community knows what we need best in our education. We're going to have students listen to students, parents lead listening, sessions for parents, and teachers lead listening sessions for teachers. We're going to create a plan, draft that plan, and give that plan to education, not corporate consultants, to ensure that the plan is feasible and effective, and give that to our School Reform Commission in Philadelphia so that they can vote on it and support it. And thank you for having me again. I look forward to having this conversation with you all.
We're delighted to have you. Dr. West, we have, in our book, The Rich and the Rest of Us, we talk about the link between education and poverty. Brother Azeem starts out with a powerful point that both the left and the right in this country agree with, that education has historically been the way out. Jordan Harris said earlier in this program, it's not the great equalizer that it once used to be. But why don't you say a word about your thoughts on this direct link between education and poverty in America, and why that link even exists?
Well, I think what dear brother started off talking about, schools in poor communities have historically been underfunded, already low priority. One of the points we've been making on this tour is that we do stand alongside our brothers and sisters of all colors in Chicago this very moment, where there's a historical struggle taking place, historical battle taking place. And there are human beings on both sides. It means, of course, you always have inadequacies and so forth. But when you have moneyed folk moving into poor communities, using public money for private institutions, or sometimes even money-driven institutions, you see, then some kind of battle is going to take place. In New York City, we have this struggle, the closing of schools and then replacing it with those kind of charter schools that people think somehow has some magical power to deliver. We have not yet seen it. Where's the evidence? Show us the data. So what's going on in Chicago is historic, because it's not just a class struggle and labor against the city, but Chicago is chocolate. It's 85% of the precious young people are our precious Latino children, our precious black children. So that there's always a racial dimension alongside this struggle of economic justice. But as humanists, we're concerned about every child, no matter what color, and every teacher, no matter what color. We want accountability across the board, but we don't want the kind of thing that you all are struggling against. So I salute you and what you're doing here in Philadelphia. Philadelphia actually has been a source of tremendous inspiration for teachers all around the nation. And in Chicago, they talk about the struggles you all have had here, so you should know that.
Yeah, we salute all young people in the Philadelphia Student Union for at least taking an active role in their own futures. All right, brother, you're awfully kind. You're awfully kind to wait, and so I promise to come back to you in this hour with questions and comments. We'll start with you, and whatever's on your mind, share it with us, and let's have some dialogue.
Good morning. First and foremost, I don't even know if I have a question anymore, because the flow of the dialogue has addressed any question that I wanted to ask. But looking at the poverty tour and you beginning in the key battleground states, what I notice is, all for the exception of maybe Ohio, the other three are the original 13 colonies. So thinking about a comment Dr. West mentioned about poverty being so systemic, is that America has forgotten its poverty since it was founded. And so now we have a political system that has not only removed itself from that which it was kind of founded on, but it's not only stuck its head in the sand to address it, but that I don't know if a social movement alone, similar to what Dr. King looked at in the 60s with the civil rights and how that would begin to address those issues. How do we, in 2012, with social media, with the empirical research that we have, that we know it exists, mm-hmm. but how do we force this government to be more accountable to the citizenry that is affecting the most?
That's a great question, Doc. Let me put his question this way. Do you think that a social movement and or social media could adequately address the poverty problem in America? Social movement and or social media, could they adequately address the poverty problem in America?
I think it depends. Thank you so much for that question, but I think it depends. We should note that Tavis and I decided not to go on this poverty tour unless we began on the Indian reservation, precisely because that's where the story, the history of this nation begins. That's where it starts. And our precious indigenous brothers and sisters do not have to be in the room for us to be sensitive about their suffering, all the hell they have caught, and since 1492, they've been dealing with World War I, and it's still going on right now.
Right now. So that when we talked about the history of the country,
slavery was not America's original sin. That's the second one. That's the second one. African slavery was number two. Indigenous people's land stolen was number one. We want to be honest about that. And so can a social movement transform a country rooted in that kind of white supremacy? I think it can, but it's going to take tremendous effort, tremendous courage, tremendous resistance. And no one of us will do it together, no one organization will do it together, no one community will do it together. And in the end, it is a global struggle. Latin America, Africa, Caribbean, and so forth. But the brother reminds us of the history that we're dealing with here.
Rashad, right quickly before I go to the next question. Since social media is the social movement of contemporary America, be honest with me and tell me what the shortcomings of that are. What are the shortcomings of social media versus social movement in the street protesting, the strategies that King and others used back in the day? What are the limitations? What are the challenges of social media as a movement?
I think one of the challenges is that I think if people think that they click something on their phone or they click something on their computer, they've done their job and they can move on. And we believe that, you know, we operate on something that we call the ladder of engagement at Color of Change. So the petition that we may send out on the email is only the first step in a longer term campaign. And then we're gonna ask people to make phone calls. We're asking people to show up to rallies. We're gonna ask people to meet with their representatives. We believe that all of this is sort of part of the longer term engagement. We believe in civic participation. And so even in this election season right now, we get a lot of messages from folks that say, just vote. Just turn out. And 4 years ago, people were told just to vote. And then folks cried and went home and were happy. And no movement was built from that voting. And what happened was we didn't have the type of adequate movement that allowed us to actually get what we went to the polls for. And so voting is really just basically like stretching to civic participation, right? It's not gonna help you lose that last 10 pounds, but if you don't do it, it's gonna hurt. And so vote, but also after you finish voting, we need to do all the other things that we need to do. We need to show up, we need to rally, we need to mobilize, and we need to hold the folks that we elect accountable. And social media is just a tool that allows us to do that. It's an extra tool, but it actually does not, it's not the actual house, it's just the hammer or the nails. And so I don't want people to put all the eggs in the basket of social right. media. If we don't have good, smart, clear strategy, leaders that are willing to be bold and hold folks accountable who are in power, and if we don't have the people who are willing to stand up and be heard, then we actually don't have a movement.
Thank you. Let me do this right quick. The next, I want to get three questions in a row. So just whatever your quick comment or question is, I'm going to take them all three, and then we'll respond to it in time.
I'll make this very quickly. Sure. First of all, I'd like to congratulate you and for you and Brother West to have the courage to speak to the power in a manner in which it should be spoken to. My name is Calvin Clinton. I'm president of the African American Workers Union. We come from Pittsburgh. You weren't on our city wasn't on your tour, so 3 o'clock this morning, I got on the road to come to you.
Oh, hello. Oh. Well, we love that, brother. Oh, yeah.
The issue that I like to speak about, and I want to see if it's common to Philadelphia, because I've been reading a lot and I know some of the politicians here in Philadelphia. Our union, which has certifications, both federal and state, for 15 different skilled trades. But in Pittsburgh, most of the time, those that are supposed to be allies, especially to the African American community, are adverse to black people working in any of the skilled trades. Now, unfortunately, we have a lot of black politicians that don't have the courage or character to fight against it. So when I applaud character and having courage, it means a lot to us in our union. They offered us $1.2 million to do pre-apprenticeship. I don't know if you know what that is, but it's like plane construction. Now, I don't know about the rest of you in the community here in Philadelphia, but you know what CDBG funds are? Community Development Block Grant Funds. That's how the conduit of funds come to usually the black community. Now, who has a bucket or a glove for it when our young people aren't trained to get it? They're not carpenters, they're not electricians, they're not plumbers. But they put them in this program called Section 3 or pre-apprenticeship, and they never develop a career in construction. As a result, they end up in a poverty cycle. Yeah. One and done, we call it. Oh, we'll let you colorize the construction project for right now, but we're not taking you with us when we go to the next project. Lord. See, that's the game that they've been playing on our community for so long, and our young people are starving for opportunity.
Yes.
To prove themselves. And many of them end up taking the wrong road because the right road is shut off from
them. That's right. That's right.
And this is what we have to do when we talk about the war on poverty, because they talk about young women and children that are engaged in poverty so much. That's because the men aren't there. The men aren't there. And many a times they're not there because they cannot live with the fact that they can't provide for what they have brought on this earth. So all I wanted to do is get the word out that we're around, that if this problem exists in Philadelphia as much as it does in Pittsburgh, we built two stadiums and a convention center, and quite frankly, we lost out on $58 million in the black community. Now, just recently, they said, well, you made $300-something million in minority construction. Then they found out that they were lying about that.
Oh, Lord.
So the idea is, if there's contractors and they're minorities, that means there's black employees or there's minority employees. That's not the case. They know that game too well. So what I'm just saying, and not taking up more of your time, but our website is aaw@aa.us. Understand our struggle.
Say that again, my brother.
AAWU.us.
Yeah,
that's our website. So as not to, this is our certification from the state of Pennsylvania. 15 different skilled trades that our young people need. I'm tired of seeing our young brothers dying in the streets between each other because they don't have enough to love about each other that they hate each other. You see, and they're closest to you is the ones that you kill. The closest ones to you. They went to school together, lived in the community together, and then they end up using a Glock against each other. We've got to change that. So I'm saying.
Give me your name again.
Kelvin Clinton from the African American Workers Union.
Brother Clinton, please give Brother Clinton some love for driving down from Pittsburgh to be with us here in Philadelphia today. I want to thank Azeem Hill. Please thank Azeem Hill for being here. Please thank him. Please thank Rashad Robinson. Please thank Vanessa Graber for being here and all the work that they're doing. You're listening to the Poverty Tour 2.0 in Philadelphia, brought to you by Pacifica and Native Voice One.
Thank you.
Welcome back to the Poverty Tour 2.0. We are in 10th Memorial Baptist Church in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. Pennsylvania is stop three on our four battleground state tour around the country. We started in Ohio, then went to Virginia. We are now, as I said, in Pennsylvania, and then on to Florida, where Dr. West and I, Cornel West and Tavis Smiley, trying to get a real conversation about poverty in this country, why it's not a priority. As I keep saying, for those who may have just tuned in, if you've been following the news of late, as yet, President Obama and Governor Romney have not really had a real conversation about poverty. We don't know what either of their plans are going forward to eradicate poverty in America. Dr. West and I were on MSNBC with Morning Joe this morning.
Oh, yeah.
And Joe and his guests, before we came on, we were sitting in the studio listening, and they were running the latest poll numbers. The latest poll numbers are being run, were being discussed this morning about how the race is shaping up. And Mr. Obama, President Obama, is pulling ahead in these battleground states. He's pulled ahead in Ohio. He's pulled ahead in Florida. Now, of course, don't clap too loud or too fast, because at this point, Michael Dukakis was up 18 points. Yeah, 19 actually, 19. To be exact, 18 points something, yeah. So Dukakis was up basically 19 points at this same place, and we know what happened when he got in that tank with the little helmet on. So Michael Dukakis is still called Governor Dukakis and not former President Dukakis. So we know that anything can happen, but President Obama is starting, according to the data, to pull away in these states. Now more than ever, there needs to be a conversation in these battleground states about this issue. And why should the conversation happen now? Because we hating on the president? No. Because if this president wins re-election, he will have at best, if he continues to expand his lead, he will at best go into a second term with some kind of mandate. Some kind of mandate to do something. At worst, he will go in, if he wins handily, with some wiggle room to get something done in the first couple years before he becomes a lame duck. And so we are just saying to the president, if he gets reelected, or Mr. Romney, if he were to win, we want poverty to be a priority in your administration. We kept getting reminded during the Democratic Convention that the first thing President Obama did when he got elected and got inaugurated was to sign what? Lilly Ledbetter. See, you all know it because you heard it so many times at the Democrat. They told us that every hour on the hour. Every speaker mentioned Lilly Ledbetter. Do a word search on that. She got mentioned more than anybody at the Democratic Convention. I'm glad the president did that. All we're saying is you did Lilly Ledbetter in your first term. In your second term, make your first order of business calling a White House conference on the eradication of poverty. Bring the experts together and let's craft and create a national plan to cut poverty in half in 10 years, to alleviate in 25 years. So this ain't hating on President Obama. It's about trying to give him an agenda to jump on the minute he gets reelected, if these poll numbers hold
Absolutely.
Up. We shall see
Absolutely.
In the coming weeks. And so we've been talking.
We should just add that what we also said this morning was that the sheer mediocrity and mendacity of Brother Mitt Romney's running amok, which means that the chances of him winning are less and less. And that's very important, because a Romney takeover would be catastrophic. But at the same time, the conditions for poor people is still disastrous. And that's why the focus has to remain there, even as Brother Barack Obama makes his move into a second term. Because in the end, it's not about Obama, it's not about just any of us individually. It's about a cause that is greater than each and every one of us.
So we've been talking to all kinds of folks as we travel around the country. And we should mention right quick that all of the major candidates were offered an opportunity anytime, any day, anywhere on this tour to join us in person or by phone to address the nation through this tour on the issue of poverty. Mr. Romney declined, saying that it was a worthy issue, but it didn't fit into his schedule. We have yet to hear on day three from the Obama campaign, not even a response from the Obama campaign. But Mr. Romney did respond, say a worthy issue, but he couldn't fit into the schedule. No response from the Obama campaign. And we were joined in Cleveland on the very first stop. We were joined by Jill Stein, Dr. Jill Stein, who happens to be the Green Party candidate for president, same party on which Ralph Nader ran a few years back. So, interestingly, here in Philadelphia, the vice presidential candidate for the Green Party sits in front of us. Please welcome Sherry Honkola. And on either side of Sherry, since this is radio, you can't, well, the webcast, you can see this, but on radio, you can't see this. On either side of her are two individuals she's brought with her, because we want to now have a conversation about something that we see far too much of across the country. I don't know about here in Philadelphia or Pennsylvania, but in my neighborhood and everywhere else I go, I see too many signs that read FORECLOSURE, foreclosure. Too many foreclosure signs all across America. And part of what's pushed so many Americans into poverty, losing their home. You lose your home, or you have a catastrophic illness, it's over. You're in poverty. As my friend says, you'll be in poverty before God gets the news. That's how fast it happens when you lose your home when you have a catastrophic illness. And so we want to talk about, in the 11 minutes we have left in this hour, we want to talk about this issue of foreclosure. So Ms. Honkola, let me start with you, though. Say congratulations on being the vice presidential candidate for the Green Party. And very quickly, because I want to use this time to talk about this issue, but tell me why you're running, what you think the Green Party can do, and to those who believe that a vote. We talked to Dr. Stein about this in Cleveland. There are a lot of folk who were mad at Ralph Nader a few years ago because they thought Ralph Nader gave Bush the election. Not that Al Gore lost it or that the Supreme Court stole it, but that Ralph Nader was to blame for running as a third-party candidate. So for those who are thinking right now that a vote for the Green Party or any third party is a wasted vote, right quickly, about that, you say what?
Well, I think it was yesterday the polls came out that right now if people were to vote, 2.4 million people would cast their vote for a Green. And I would say that you can't really spoil something that's rotten. Right now, for the 8 million families that have lost their homes to foreclosure, the young man that recently died, who was 14 in Kansas because he was undocumented and couldn't prove that he had ongoing health care issues, tell that to his mother that things are okay or that things have gotten better. And I'm sitting next to two women that are currently in foreclosure right now, and I'm the first woman ever that lived in a car, lived outside with my son, almost froze to death on the streets of Minnesota, and am now running for Vice President of the United States of America. I now have my own hate sites, but I've never been well adjusted to injustice. And my mother taught me, a woman who I was taken from my mother as a child and raised in 9 different institutions before I was 16, because they didn't have battered women shelters. My mom always told me, you do what you believe in, and you help those that are around you. And that's what I've been doing for 25 years across this entire country.
No, you long distance struggler for justice, but also anti-poverty advocate.
Yes.
Absolutely. But let me ask this question, because there's no doubt that under the present administration that would bail out banks with trillions of dollars, but not bail out homeowners dealing with foreclosure. So that, and when the money came, it was $28 billion, but we need $700 billion to deal with fellow citizens who are underwater in terms of paying, keeping up with their bills, as it were. How does one convince fellow citizens that a break from the two-party system won't reinforce the worst of a rotten system? Then we're going to get to our two sisters here who wrestling on the ground and with their prevailing situation with regard to their houses.
Change has to start somewhere. And I tried the Democratic Party, and sometimes it works for some folks, and for other folks it doesn't work. I ran for Philadelphia sheriff here, and I ran on a zero foreclosure platform that if I was elected, I was going to refuse to throw families out of their homes. Well, I wasn't elected, and you know, now every month, 2,000 families' homes are on the chopping block, and they're losing their homes. And for me, that's not okay. So I just want to say that now, Jill and I, about a month ago, we went to jail. We took over Fannie Mae, along with Rhonda and Miss Fran here and a bunch of other folks, because we wanted somebody to at least give them their day in court so that they could hold on to their homes. That hasn't happened. You know, I just want to lift up Glenn Davis, who's here in the audience too. He's waiting to lose his home as well. And, you know, I brought a bunch of people that are here today as well that are from New Jerusalem that have been cut from the 40,000 from cut from public assistance and are going to have no way to eat or house themselves. And I got a family of 5 at my house that needs some place to live. So I'm always very pragmatic wherever I go. Mm. So if anybody can help with these very real issues right now, it'd be great if people could step to me later.
Sister Rhonda, you want to share your story and reflections?
Well, for the blessing, first of all, let me thank you guys for coming to Philly, and it's my honor to finally see you in person instead of through CNN. start with Sherry. I have been fighting my housing battle for 3 years. My mother passed away 3 years ago, and you know, they got into a very ugly battle with the bank, which seems to be procedural now from what I'm understanding. A lot of people are going through the same thing. And anyway, I had talked to Reverend Al Sharpton's people, and they were interested in taking my case, but then the same week the Trayvon Martin story broke, so they weren't able to take it, and I understood that completely. I was at peace with that. I saw Sherry, ironically, on CNN several years ago, and I found her through the network, and she met with me, and I said, if she doesn't take my case, it's a wrap. Well, she did take my case, and the next thing I know, I'm on the front page, not the 6th page, but the front page of the Philadelphia Metro. I went to work, and I was like, I had a bag over my head, because it's like my, you know, my house and everything is on the front page. But thanks to Sherry, my case has moved forward. I've had a lot of support from people in my community where I've lived for 35 years, and my case is now in federal court. So it has taken a step up, and my case has also become national. It's got a lot of press. I've been in the Chicago, the Miami Herald, the Chicago Tribune, I think I was interviewed. So my case is well known. The second part that makes it so well known is that I work in music. I work professionally in music. I had a very great career in music until my mother got sick prior to her passing away. But anyway, those two environments have allowed me to put this on a national platform, and I have decided that with the incorporation of my music career, I am now reaching out to other people, specifically the demographic of musicians, because what I found out when I was in Los Angeles recently is we have artists who have made a lot of money who are now bankrupt and are now losing their homes at a fast pace.
Oh yeah.
So from that, I have designed a website, Artists Against Foreclosure. I'll talk about that a little bit later, because we cannot afford to have people, doesn't matter what the demographic is, we just can't afford to have people in the streets. Our shelters are filled to the brims. The economic system, as we've already heard, is in collapse. And we need to turn this thing around. This is likened to what I have always said was the heroin epidemic of the 1970s. I mean, people are just getting thrown out of their homes at a mind-boggling rate. And the only way I see to turn this around because of what I'm going through is for us to do a grassroots movement. That's the only way we're going to change this.
Let me jump in. This is Rhonda Lancaster, who you just heard telling her story. We mentioned earlier in this program that there are a couple of quick ways to find yourself in poverty, or at least wrestling with staying out of it. A catastrophic illness, her mother dies, and of course you lose your job or the economy is tight on you. The combination of those two things puts you in some trouble, and so you find yourself fighting foreclosure. So that's Rhonda Lancaster's story. I'm watching our time here. Never enough time, even with 3 hours, to get to all these issues that we want to get to. But Fran Scarsborough, tell me your story right quick, Fran.
Say it again?
I want to hear your story, yeah.
The problem is that the mortgage company does not want to hear from you.
Yeah, speak right in that microphone.
My situation is that I got sick, lost some time from work, fell behind in my mortgage, but the problem is that the mortgage company does not want to hear from you, will not negotiate with you. When you send in your payments, they send them back. And the next thing you know, their lawyers have your case. And once the lawyers have it, forget it. They're straight away going to take your house. And let me tell you, if you settle with the mortgage company, that lawyer, that's a job gone for him. So he doesn't want you to settle. He's not working for the best interest that I can see of his client. He just wants the time on the books. He gets paid by the hour. The more time he puts in, the more money he makes, and he wants to go through that process. And that process is the foreclosure, eventual sheriff's sale of your property, and the eviction process, suing you for eviction, and the ultimate eviction of you from your home. And it happened to me so quickly that I couldn't bat an eye that I was evicted from my house after having fought them for 15 years. This mortgage company went behind my back, went to a judge and got a court order overturned to sell my house. They were having so much difficulty succeeding with me that they had to do a trick. The city of Philadelphia had a new program where it said, well, we're going to make arrangements for you to, through a housing counselor, meet with the mortgage company finally. I'm like, great, maybe now I can get a modification instead of going to bankruptcy, which I had tried to do four different times and was having a lot of difficulty through bankruptcy. That's a hard thing to do. You have to make two payments. Here I go, and I go to the sheriff's sale to be sure that, well, in any event, I went to the sheriff's sale to make sure that my house was not going to be sold because I was told it wouldn't. And lo and behold, the mortgage company had gone that very day and got permission to sell my house and to erase the court order that I had that was going to allow me to participate in the program.
I'm up against a break, and I hate that. I wanted to make sure that we had Sherry on this program with Sister Fran and Sister Rhonda, because I wanted us to see, not just drive past these homes and see these signs in the yard, but to see in live, in living person, in living color, live and in living color, and see the humanity of these persons who are wrestling with these kinds of issues every day. There are millions of Americans who are dealing with this same crisis, fighting for years, 15 years, fighting, trying to hold on to their home.
I'm currently in my car, sleeping outside that home.
And we're reoccupying both of these properties. So anybody that's interested in helping us keeping these families in these homes, let us
please,
know.
And please,
how would they contact you, Sister Sherry?
They can contact us through the Poor People's Economic Human Rights Campaign.
Okay.
Our office is in Kensington. And you can email me at Sherry Honkala, Poor People's Economic Human Rights Campaign @gmail.com.
Please thank Sherry Honkala, Sister Rhonda and Sister Fran. We're pulling for you, praying for you. Honored to have you on this program. You're listening to The Poverty Tour 2.0 in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, brought to you by Pacifica and Native Voice One.
Savior, when storms are raging, he is my shelter. Where he lead me, I will follow. I love Jesus, and he loves me. Oh, I love him, yes I do. 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 I love him, yes I do.
I love Jesus, and he loves me.
Yeah, I love Jesus, he is my savior. When storms are raging, he is my shelter. Where he leads me, I will follow. I love Jesus, and he loves me. Yes, I love him, yes I do. 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 I love Jesus, and he loves me. Hey, I love Jesus, he is my savior. When storms are raging, he is my shelter. Where he lead me, I will follow. I love Jesus, and he loves me. Yes, I love him, yes I do. 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 I love Jesus, and he loves me. Hey, I love Jesus. He is my savior. When storms are raging, he is my shelter. Where he leads me, I will follow. I love Jesus, and he loves me. Yes, I love him, yes I do. 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 I love Jesus, and he loves me. Yes, I love him, yes I do. 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 I love Jesus, and he loves me.
Yes, I love him. Yes, I do. Some of us really love him. Joshua, let me tell.
Welcome back to the Poverty Tour 2.0 from Philadelphia. Yeah. From Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. This is the third stop on our four swing state poverty tour here at the 10th Memorial Baptist Church. In the last hour, this time has gone really fast.
Last hour. Hard to believe, brother.
But that story was those stories.
Oh.
Sister Fran,
powerful.
And Sister Rhonda.
And yet the dignity was there, the grace was there, the style was there, a smile was on their face. They never allowed the misery to have the last word.
Out of her house.
Very important.
Out of her house, Sister Fran, out of her house and into her car, even as we speak.
Absolutely.
That's what so many millions of Americans are dealing with right now, so I'm glad that we were able to have that conversation. Let's talk now with Tony Larson and Jesse Poole. about a program called Food Not Bombs. Food Not Bombs. When I was walking, Doc and I were walking into the church 3 hours ago to start this conversation, I saw some people bringing food in. And the pastor's wife, First Lady Moore, came to me and said, did you order some food? Because we didn't order food, and there are some people bringing some food into the church. And I sent my assistant out because I didn't know who they were, and I certainly didn't. I hadn't invited anybody in to come in and start making money by selling people food. I hadn't approved that. Didn't know anything about it, so I didn't want to be disrespectful to the church with somebody coming in and trying. Because you know how we are. We will set up something real fast when we got a crowd of people. Got them hot dogs. Cheesesteak. So I didn't know what was going on. And I sent my assistant out, and we discovered, lo and behold, that it was Food Not Bombs, and they were the ones bringing in the food. So let me just ask Tony right quick, Tony Larson, to explain what Food Not Bombs is, what you're doing, and why you were bringing food into the church. So just give me a quick top line for me, Tony.
First of all, hello, everybody. Good afternoon, and welcome to Philadelphia, gentlemen.
Thank you.
It's an honor and a pleasure.
Good to see you.
We didn't know we were going to be behind microphones, so we don't have anything prepared. So if I start rambling, please cut me off, you know. Food Not Bombs is I don't know if it's an organization. It's a group that's around the country, and maybe it's an idea. And the basic premise is that healthy food is a right, not a privilege. And our government needs to focus less on war and more about poverty issues and health issues and feeding people here at home. So basically what happens is friends get together and connect with farmers markets, with supermarkets, with health food stores, or with people with gardens, and see if there's any surplus, and they cook and serve food. Sometimes they don't even cook, they just bring bags of produce, of baked goods, and give it out in parks. So another thing that comes of that is that there's a public face to poverty. I mean, it's open to anyone. I've seen people in business suits go and get food, and minus the business suit, I've been in that position where I'll go and enjoy Food Not Bombs cooking. But what happens is there's a public face to often homeless issues, and sometimes that creates tension with police or with local government, but Food Not Bombs tries to show that face just by feeding.
I'm glad you said that, because I was just about to ask whether or not there's any harassment. And I wasn't thinking a moment ago about law enforcement harassment. I was thinking about the department here in Philadelphia that's in charge of making sure that you have a license, the health department. You don't want people to be getting food that's spoiled or that's bad and people get sick from it. So every city, of course, every municipality has some department that makes sure that food that's given away or sold on streets, you know, you ought to have a license for that. So how does that work? How do you just give food away? And tell me more about the police who don't always understand what you're trying to do with Food Not Bombs.
Well, historically, there has been a lot of friction, especially in San Francisco, Oakland area. Some decades ago, there was a lot of trouble with police, and which created a lot of advertisement for Food Not Bombs in general. So in a way, maybe it was a good thing. Right now in Philadelphia, this last year, there's been a lot of push to ban public feedings down the parkway, where we have a new museum and where there's a lot of tourism and where a homeless presence is not always appreciated by officials. So Food Not Bombs does not have licenses and does not plan on getting licenses, and just says feeding people is a right, and people should have access to good food. You know, we shouldn't be doing it. Really, there should be access to locally grown produce, healthy vegetables, and it should not cost an arm and a leg.
I hope the mayor and the police chief ain't listening right about now.
Yeah. and I'd have to add that it's also a very loose-knit group. I have not been involved lately in the day-to-day. There's a group in West Philadelphia and in North Philadelphia that do public feedings down at the public library and at Cedar Park in West Philly. And there are young people there who've been doing it week in and week out, busting their tails. And I saw that there'd been a call from your people, and we found out yesterday, and so they couldn't do it. And so it's a loose-knit group, and it's somewhat anarchic. So, you know, whoever wants to get involved, So trying to make it happen.
So Jesse Poole, speaking of getting involved, how did you get involved? How did you become part of the pool, Jesse?
Well, me, I've been working with the Urban Nutritionist Director from University High School, University of Penn, for a while, since I was 15 years old. It was my first job I ever had. So therefore, it's like the same thing Tony said, to piggyback on what he said, you know, working in the community, trying to provide healthy food after leading for our community. So, I mean, I got the message off of Facebook from Tony, like, last night, you know, to come here and volunteer my services to help set the food and make sandwiches and stuff like that for people here.
Yeah. Tony, you mentioned earlier that you've seen people in suits from time to time come to get food. That does not surprise me. It might surprise some of us in the audience, but it doesn't surprise me. Because again, I know these stats. When the Agriculture Department, and for those who might not have heard this earlier or who are just tuning in, recently our Agriculture Department put new data out that suggested 50 million Americans go to bed every night not having had enough to eat in that day. 50 million Americans, 9 million of them are children. You could fill the entire equivalent, I should say, to the state of California and Illinois. So imagine that California and Illinois, the entire states, go to bed hungry every night. That's how severe a problem we have in this country. This is not a third world country, but this is what happens in this country every night. So when you said earlier, Tony, you've seen people coming in suits to get food, give me some sense of what at least you see on the regular. What kinds of people? Are they destitute, homeless, sleeping on the sidewalk? That's one of the faces of poverty. But beyond that, what are you seeing? What is there a prototype of person that you see it on the regular?
Well, again, I have to add that I have not been involved in the daily.
That's your distribution of it.
Recently, right. Jesse and I have worked in the last 5 years with a group, Urban Nutrition Initiative. So we're co-workers and friends, and we're just volunteering today to represent Food Not Bombs. But from my experiences in the past, there's of course homeless folks, people who are in transitional phases, but also a lot of young people, artists. You know, there's not a lot of things out there where sometimes you get whatever job you can, where if people are feeding in a park, that helps out. And even if it's once a week, people show up and you see people from all walks of life.
Right.
So
I had a question. If you would allow us to eavesdrop on your conversations with your friends, with your peers, what do they say to you when you say you are involved in Food Not Bombs? Both the encouraging comments, but also some of the, maybe not critical, but maybe they don't fully grasp, because this seems to be something both of you are deeply committed to in your own ways. And I just wonder, what kind of dialogue do you have with the young folk now?
Well, I'm only 22, as I say, but I've been doing since I was 15. But some people don't grasp onto it. They look and be like, no, I want to eat that, or no, it's not me. Some people come on and try it. And they're the ones that continue to work with us and they join the organization. You know, I had friends like my friend Kwanda, Keith, you know, people who joined the program through me that I was talked to, you know, seeing how I was, seeing how excited I was teaching new kids, you know, becoming a teacher, teaching the youth that are younger than us, come in and join and start like helping out, learning how to cook and remember the things, like how to eat healthy and ways to get around that. You know, we're not saying you can't eat, you can eat whatever you want, but we're trying to say, you know, exercise, slow down a little bit, you know what I mean? Add some health things in, because we don't know what's good for it, what's not. So when I have conversation, though, some people make jokes, you know, you just ate a cheesesteak or something last week, now you want to go eat a banana or eat some fruit salad. So and I was telling, like, man, you still have those habits that you're trying to break, so it's still there. So, you know, you're still going to run the store, you know, run a fast food joint, or run to get some quick Chinese store, you know. But, like, during the day, you can also add some water in your system, you know, add a piece of fruit, I mean, get some naturalness back to your body, you know, help regulate your system. You know, that's what I also tell them.
We appreciate the work that you are doing, the work that Food Not Bombs is doing. This is the Poverty Tour 2.0 from 10th Memorial Baptist Church in Philadelphia. We'll continue with more in just a moment. This is being brought to you by Pacifica and Native Voice One.
We have, if I may add, we have a buffet of food in the lobby that was actually made with eggplants that were raised by our youth in Philadelphia, our youth as in your youth, our youth, the city's youth, and we encourage everyone to come try. There's local breads, we made some sandwiches, try things out, take things home. Come talk to us, please.
Thank you.
incarcerated. This generation is all about mass incarceration.
But is it three of them or two? Poverty Tour 2.0. What a good time we're having here at 10th Memorial Baptist Church. And you all know you cannot talk about poverty in America unless you talk about the prison industrial complex, the new Jim Crow that Michelle Alexander talks about with such insight. You all know the book, The New Jim Crow. This is the 41st anniversary of the rebellion at Attica. We're having a program tonight. We're getting on the train and going straight to New York City, Riverside Church. Angela Davis, Michelle Alexander, myself, and others will be talking, as well as Mumia Abu-Jamal, who's piped in from the prison, will be there in New York. If you're religious, pray for us. If you're not, just think pleasant thoughts. But we are so very blessed to have not three, but four. Oh, we got a little pressure on there, indeed, indeed. We got Sister Teresa, yes, and the little precious one's name is?
This is Sabria.
Sabria. Give Sister Sabria a hand. Give Sister Sabria a hand. We love you, Sabria. We've got Brother Joshua, is that right?
Yes, sir.
Yes, give Brother Joshua a hand. And our dear Sister Sarah. Sarah? Sister Sarah, give her a hand, give her a hand.
The name of this group is called Decarcerate. It's called Decarcerate. As Doc said a moment ago, you can't talk about poverty without talking about the links to the prison industrial complex. And as he mentioned, we'll be in New York tonight for a major program at Riverside, sort of a kind of a detour from the poverty tour, but yet directly linked to poverty. So we're going to do that. And then, as we said earlier, head on down to Florida for our last stop on this poverty tour tomorrow. But Sarah, Joshua, I don't know who wants to go first, but tell us about Decarcerate, what it is, what you're doing. Give us some insights into what you're up to and what the link is between your work and poverty.
Well, thank you for having us, first of all. Decarcerate PA is a statewide coalition of organizations and individuals that is fighting to end mass incarceration in Pennsylvania and the many harms that it brings to our communities. And we formed actually just about a year and a half ago in response to the massive expansion of the prison system that's happening in Pennsylvania right now. Right now the state is spending about $685 million to build three new state prisons and expand nine existing prisons. They're just breaking ground right now on two new prisons that will house 4,100 people, additional people just outside of Philadelphia as we speak. So we're fighting to end that expansion. And we have a three-point platform that demands no new prisons in Pennsylvania. We don't want one more new prison bed built in Pennsylvania. But we also recognize that it's not just about the beds, but it's more about the people filling those beds. And we can't just say no new prison beds without looking at why so many people are in prison in Pennsylvania. So, you know, when you look at our prison population in 1980, there were about 8,000 people in prison in this state. Today, there's over 51,000 people in our state prisons. There were 370 elderly prisoners in prison in Pennsylvania in 1980. There are over 8,000 elderly prisoners today, which is, you know, grandmothers, grandfathers, and that has to do a lot with our sentencing laws, which haven't made our communities any safer, but have drastically increased the number of people in our prisons. And so we're demanding real sentencing reform. We're demanding parole eligibility for lifers, for the over 5,000 men and women who will never even get a chance to make the case for why they should be allowed to come home. We're demanding that the state re-examine all of its mandatory minimum laws, which the state itself has acknowledged in report after report have no impact on whether a person goes back to prison. And we're demanding that instead that the state end the failed drug war on drugs, over 18%.
Yeah. Sarah, for those listening right now, and I know you've heard this question before, but I've not heard your answer, and I want to hear it. For those listening right now who are saying, you know, in the words of that Sammy Davis Jr. classic that opened up the Beretta TV show. You're too young to remember Beretta. Y'all remember the song, "Don't Do the Crime If You Can't Do the Time." Don't do the crime if you can't do the time. How do you respond to people who say, you know, I hear your argument and you're doing good work and God bless you, but don't do the crime if you can't do the time?
Well, what I would say to that is, you know, it's true that people need to be held accountable for their actions, but you can't look at our prison system and not acknowledge that it's still the case that the degree to which people are held accountable in our society still depends in large part on the color of your skin, on the neighborhood you grew up in, and on how much money you have in your bank account. And Michelle Alexander lays it out really well. One example is in the book The New Jim Crow. Michelle Alexander talks about the fact that people of color and white people use and sell drugs at about the same rates equal to their percentage of the population, and yet African Americans make up 13% of the population and 50% of people in prison on drug offenses. And when you just look at those numbers, you can't try to pretend that we have a criminal justice system that treats people equally. The last part of what I would say is that part of what we're also demanding is that instead of investing all that money into the prison system, we invest in the things that make our communities safer and make our communities more stable, which are schools, community centers, healthcare centers.
Yes, yes, yes. No, indeed, indeed. I know we're going to get to Brother Joseph, but I just want to mention, you know, Carl Dix, myself, and others, we called for that struggle against stop and frisk.
Yeah.
Went to jail, had the verdict, guilty verdict. Why? Because 700,000 young folks stopped and frisked, 86% black and brown. But you notice they don't really highlight the crimes on Wall Street. Oh, there's criminal activity taking place there. No prosecution. Not one bank has gone to jail. But Jamal and Letitia or Juanita get caught with a crack bag and they go to jail. Now see, that's the racism of the system, you see. Based on the love that we have for everybody, but especially the folks that our dear Sister Sarah was talking about. Brother Josh, give us
your
name.
How you doing? My name is Josh, and I'm also a member of the Carcerate PA, but I also work with an organization called the Youth Arts Self-Empowerment Project, and we're a youth-led organization that work with young people that are charged as adults, and we do art and poetry workshops every weekend in the Philadelphia County Jails with young people charged as adults. And we also started going to schools talking about structural violence, the school-to-prison pipeline, and we started letting young people know what's going on so that they can make a change, a positive change in the community. And a lot of young people, they don't have the knowledge about these things, so, you know, we're trying to give them that knowledge. And also, we also employ young people part-time upon release from the adult prisons so that, you know, we can guide them back into the society in a good way. But I'm gonna jump back into the Carcerate PA. We have a vicious cycle going on. We have young people going to underfunded schools, living in poor urban communities. We have adults that's locked up, and, you know, then when they get out, they get labeled, so it's hard for them to get jobs. And these are the parents of these same young people that are going through this poor school system. And we have young people growing up without mentors and people to help guide them in a poor neighborhood. And, you know, then we have a community that's underfunded with resources and outlets for people to, you know, actually be successful. So that's a bad combination. And as long as we don't stand up, and then we have people that's hopeless in our community that don't think they can do anything about it, or, you know, too busy to be able to do anything about it because, you know, they work three jobs, they work four jobs, you know, and it's nasty. So we have to stand up, and we have to demand to the state to actually make a change, and we have to tell them how to make a change. And that's a part of what the Carcerate PA is doing. You know, we came up with things that we know what reduce the crime rate, you know, investing in schools, investing in rec centers, investing in, you know, programs to help ex-offenders. Because at the end of the day, most people that go to jail, they come back into our community. And, you know, they have to either find a job and be successful, or they have to rob, or they have to, you know, sell drugs or whatever. They have to do crime. So, you know, but it only depends on how much we help them upon release, though. And we don't have proper programs for people that are coming out of jails. And also, I don't know if anybody know, but they spending $685 million to build three new prisons. This is PA, the state PA. They spending $685 million to build three new prisons and expand old facilities, but they cut $550 million from basic education. What do that tell you? And, you know, we all, at some point, our community, we disconnected. The youth and the adults, it's not that connection that we used to have back in the day. You know what I mean? And a lot of people don't understand how important it is for us to like really stand up, like take the streets, and that's what Decarcerate PA does too. We go out in the streets and like we actually rally and we like really, really demand that, you know, our money, our taxpayers' money be invested in things that can help the community, not things that can help, you know, people expand prison to get more money off of prisons, because that's what they're trying to do, so.
No, that's strong, that's strong. Now give Brother Josh a hand. Sister Teresa, Sister Teresa. You can see Josh is on fire. It was a beautiful thing to behold, my brother. Sister Teresa.
I don't think that mic is on. Why don't you use
Hi, I'm Teresa Shooks. Thanks for having us. I also work with Decarcerate PA, and I'm also a member of the Human Rights Coalition Group, and we work to help family members of loved ones in prison to organize against the present-day prison system. We're also fighting against solitary confinement. There are over 80,000 folks in solitary across the country, and people are being thrown in 23-hour lockdown just for voicing or going up against the present-day prison system. You get thrown in those type of lockdowns. Most folks can't handle it. You have these young boys strolling in off the street, and once they're in 23-hour lockdown, they can't handle it. And we have boys that are taking their lives in their 20s here in Pennsylvania, but you don't hear about it because most of our prisons are in rural Pennsylvania. So their area receives all of this, the information in reference to what's going on with our youth in prison. I want to let you know, and you know, when we talk about crime in the black community, drugs and guns just don't fall from the sky.
Right.
They
got to
come
right.
from somewhere.
That's right. That's right.
And when we talk about the crime that are against the poor black folks and just incarcerating our people, when you look at Bernie Madoff, he didn't use a gun. He used a pen. But he wiped out a lot of folks. And believe me, he didn't do that by himself. He's taking the full blame of it, but he gets placed in a federal cozy prison. We also have to look at we are taxpayers. We're living in a fool's paradise. That's what my father would say, who spent some 40 years in prison now, 30 years in solitary confinement, because he has a voice. He's able to lead the youth behind bars, and the prison officials want to keep him locked down so that voice isn't taken and used against the injustice that's going on in the present-day prison system. I was forced to bring this little one up, this little girl, Sabria. She's actually my foster child. Mm-hmm. I've also taken a stand and began taking foster kids in my home. I just started February, but I can't stand around and watch my community be in an uproar without taking a stand. We have to take a stand and work with our teenagers. So since February, I've had 3 17-year-olds and 2 of them with babies. And now I have 2 younger ones also. We have a lot of folks in our community that are scared of our youth. Yes, we are, but there's a widespread there. And I contribute some of that to the crack epidemic. Because we got kids that were addicted to crack that are raising kids now. So there was a big loss there. So that's like the drugs that supposedly just fell out of the sky as a pipeline to the prison system. As Sarah stated earlier, $600 million going to build 3 new prisons, and you got teachers that are on strike in Chicago. Teachers are underpaid. We can't ask our governor to put that into our public school system. We are the taxpayers. That's our money. You are using your taxpaying dollars to house prisoners. It's your money. We are living in a taxpayer's fool's paradise when you allow your tax dollars to be taken away from your children.
Yes, 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 Sister Teresa. Fire for justice. I'm telling you. Oh, you got so much love and so much commitment to justice inside of you. It's a magnificent thing.
And we're in the right place for it because we at 10th Memorial Baptist Church.
Right.
Yes, and then we're talking about the love in this place. We talking about the love, and that's true for all three of y'all, all four of y'all. Look at her, look at her. You see, when you were speaking, she just standing there so proud.
Right.
And her eyes so beautiful.
Because everyone, every youth that comes through my door, I had one kid come in 17. She said, Miss, you must be crazy. You know what I did? I had a high-speed chase with the cops. You're crazy. You don't know me. I said, what I do know is you step through a door where you get a second chance. I don't need to know your history.
Yes.
I'm going to give
That's
you
right.
this ground base
That's
that
right.
will
That's
go
right.
with you for life.
That's
I don't need the history. And when we look at our youth that are going to prison, how many of us have made a mistake as a teenager?
Oh,
and they're locking teenagers up.
No.
Lifetime sentences.
5 mistakes, 10 mistakes, 15 mistakes.
Right.
We still turned around. Oh, yeah.
Sarah, for those who are listening, I've only got 3 minutes, and I got to take another break and have one last segment where we can get nothing but questions in. You've been so patient. But have you been enjoying this information? 3 hours of just good information about all the issues connected to poverty and what needs to be done to alleviate poverty in this country. Sarah, how would you answer the question as to what is driving this significant increase in the prison population in Pennsylvania? I mean, obviously it's growing across the country, but those numbers you cited earlier are mind-boggling about how fast this rate of incarceration has grown in the Keystone State. What's going on?
Well, I think a lot of it, as I said before, has been driven by policies that were passed to get people elected rather than to make our community safer. I think that a lot of these policies, you know, we look at mandatory minimum sentencing. The Pennsylvania Sentencing Commission did a report in 2007 that found that mandatory minimum sentencing has no impact on recidivism, has no impact on whether people are going to commit another crime when they come home, and yet that's been one of the driving forces in increasing our prison population. Right now, you know, the state legislature right now is considering a law that would create a new five-year mandatory minimum for gun possession. When, you know, you look at the fact that when somebody, you send somebody to prison, you put them in a cage for 5 years, how does that make them less likely to pick up a gun when they come home? You know, we're not looking at the things that actually create safe communities. And I think, honestly, a lot of these laws are being passed by legislators who not only aren't impacted directly and their loved ones aren't impacted by the prison system, but they're also not impacted by the violence in our communities. And I don't believe that they have that's really what's driving them to pass these kinds of laws.
I want to just, Teresa, what you'd say to African Americans in particular, because you're an African American, I am. What do you say to black folk in particular? Because I've seen studies about this, as I'm sure you have as well. Black folk are tired of being victimized in their neighborhoods. Yes, we want justice. We want fairness and equity in the way that justice is meted out. We want it to be done in a fair way. But we also want to be not victimized in our neighborhoods. We also don't want our homes broken in. We don't want to be hit upside the back of the head when we're trying to go to the ATM. So black people want to be safe in their neighborhoods as much as we want justice meted out. How do you balance those two things?
I want to be safe also. I have a 22-year-old son, Amel, that have to walk through my community also, and I'm right in the hood of 52nd Street. What I say is we have to begin to talk to our youth. They're not understanding us. We're not understanding them. It's almost like rap music. You know, when you were younger, you could understand the music and jam and want to go to the clubs. But then when you get older, what is that gibberish? What are they talking about? So we got to be able to connect with our youth. Really, it begins at an early age. As I stated earlier, we have parents who were addicted to crack raising kids now. So we have to educate those kids, whether it be through the arts, through music. We really have to take the time. I didn't think I had time. I have a 22-year-old that's grown to raise more kids. How many of us say, my son will be 18, my daughter, they're out of here. Really, they're never out of your life. So you do have the time to take a stand and work with our youth. The further we let this generation get away from us, the further we will be as a people. Now, what you have to do is take a stand. Black folks have never gotten anything just by saying, oh, we're going to give y'all something.
We had to fight for everything that we had got. So that's you got to fight to save your community, starting with being in your kid's school. Whatever day you take off, don't look at it as a day I'm off for the day. Go to that kid's school. Because in the 70s, when I was young, my mother ran the school and the neighborhood. When the principal did something out of order, the principal, I always say, is like the director of the orchestra. When he was out of order, the parents was right there on his butt.
Oh, yeah.
But Sister Teresa, do you agree with this? Because I think part of the challenge is this, and I want three quick things, that in the past, children were viewed as our children.
That's right.
We know that if white precious young folk were going to jail at the same level as black folk, there'd be a town hall meeting every day.
That's right.
Every day. But we also know in black America, if black middle class kids, if the Jack and Jill sisters and brothers were going to jail at the same level as folk on the block, the poor black brothers and sisters, we'd have a different kind of black leadership.
That's right.
And different kind of black way of talking about the prison industrial complex, because crime is real. But all of a sudden, poor black people not really given the same sensitive analysis as white and even more black middle class. Is that a fair characterization of what you're talking about?
Yes, it is. Yes. As I said, we're living in a food paradise. Those of us who were able to get credit cards and debit cards just within the last 4 years and buy a home that most of us are losing, that wasn't real. That wasn't real. We had to struggle for everything we had to get.
Yeah.
And our legislators, don't get me wrong, they are not helping us. They are not helping us. If you put someone in office, once he's in office, you need to be at his door and let him know who run the show and who pays his bill. All right. We have to take that stand.
All right, please thank Sister Teresa, Brother Joshua. Sarah, Decarcerate PA is the name of the organization. This is the Poverty Tour 2.0 in Philadelphia, brought to you by Pacifica and Native Voice One.
I'll see y'all this evening in New York. I'll be in New York.
Welcome back.
Welcome back to the Poverty Tour 2.0. We are in Philadelphia. This is stop three on a four swing state poverty tour. And this is the last segment of 3 hours. Have you enjoyed this gathering today? Have you learned something? Have you been inspired, empowered, uplifted? It's been such a beautiful thing to see a church packed full of people for 3 hours to be a part of this conversation. So in this last segment, we want to just take as many questions as we can. Before I do that, let me ask you to show your love for these wonderful singers. Let me call them by name. Pastor Lenora Young, Reverend Brandon Joins. Is that Joins? Is it Brandon Joins? Brandon Joins, Reverend Suzanne Harmon, Paulette Brown, and Urasha Sanders. Give them all some love. Every one of you. We love you. Y'all sounded so good today. And you lifted my spirits. And a couple of times I had to sit back down because the holy dance was coming on. I grew up in a Pentecostal church. I didn't want to show out. Get me speaking in tongues up in here.
Sometimes when the Holy Ghost hits you, it's not cute.
It's just not cute.
That's
all right. Yeah. So thank you to all this. One more time for all the singers. We love the praise team. We thank you. We thank you. We thank you. We thank you. All right. Quick questions, quick comments. We got just about 15 minutes left. We're going to cover as much as we can, as quick as we can. Yes, sir.
I'm just so thankful that I didn't go to school today, that I came here for my schooling. So as a student, I wanted to ask my teacher, Cornel West, Dr. West, just to talk about this disconnect that students have with communities. I wanted to talk about students who are so focused on succeeding, on getting good grades, on doing whatever they need to do, on not getting into debt, you know, whatever they need to do, all the pressures facing students today. How do we get them connected with the communities that are really feeling poverty, that are really feeling kind of the times that we're in? How do we get them connected with that so that the students move beyond statistics and hear stories like this, see faces like this? And then how do we get them to the next step, which is connecting with those communities, connecting among themselves, and growing something? So it's just a question.
All righty.
Thank you so much, my brother. I salute you. I'm glad you didn't go to school today, but you're going tomorrow, though, right?
Yeah, go to school.
That's good. All right. Just want to make sure. One thing we have to recognize, there's no such thing as young people's behavior that does not imitate older folk. You see, if you say, all those young folk acting like gangsters, then there's a gangster in their lives they imitate. You see, they look at politicians stealing elections, that's gangster activity. They see Wall Street obsessed with the 11th commandment, thou shalt not get caught, that's gangster activity. So anytime you look at young folk, it's a mirror of we old school folk. We haven't loved them enough, we haven't spent enough time, we haven't cared. We know we are who we are because somebody loved us and cared for us. And so the challenge is, how do we not just reconnect, but pass on this tradition so that you are freed up both to be a voice, not an echo, free, but also learn from us. And this is what the awakening that we're talking about is all about, reconnecting. Look at the relation between Curtis Mayfield and Roger Troutman in that last album. You know who Curtis Mayfield is. Genius among geniuses. Love flowing all the time. 2,000 songs in 28 years and dies paralyzed neck down. But a young brother named Roger Troutman from Zap goes to his bed and puts the microphone in his mouth, and he makes a great album with a young generation and older generation together. That's the great example that we're talking about. You stay strong, my dear brother.
Thank you very much. Yes, ma'am.
Hi, I'm really heartened by the second half of this program. Because personally, with all due respect, in the first part of the program, I felt like there was too much focus on our political leaders and what can they do. You know, it's about what we can do. You know, any successful social movement in this country has been about reframing the debate about what that oppression is. You know, going back to, you know, we forget, or at least maybe we're not taught, that, you know, Rosa Parks, 10 years before she got on that bus in 1955, was teaching young African-American teenage girls in her home every weekend about their rights. And so there's lots of reframing the debate years before anything gets done. Mm-hmm. And everyone in this room and every room that you're in on this poverty tour, I'm sure, believes in the dignity and worth of every human being on this earth. And so we all need to do our little part. Whatever it is, going back to the social media, if it's posting those provocative images on our Twitter and our Facebook, starting those dialogues, all the time I've been educating around poverty for the last 10 years, I hear from people, I don't know how to talk to my relatives who are a little bit conservative about this. This is what I believe, but how do I have that conversation with them? And we need to be brave enough, as you said earlier, we need to be brave enough to sacrifice everything. Mm-hmm. To change this situation in the country. So we need to be brave enough to have those difficult conversations.
We appreciate your comment. Thank you very much. Question or comment? Yes, ma'am. Glad to hear from you.
Hi. Thank you both. Great admirer of both of you, and thank you for this morning.
I'm an urban farmer and a beekeeper, and I just want to say that in the Bee Society, every bee has a place to live, a place to sleep, food to eat, and a job to do. That's insects, and they can manage it, and somehow we can't. So my question is...
That's a deep insight. That's a deep insight.
I have been calling for a general strike in this country since 2007. I am a refugee from the recession. And I'm also someone who happened to be in the Soviet Union in Moscow when the Soviet Union fell in 1991. I saw that firsthand. And this is deja vu for me. What's going on in this country is deja vu. I saw the supermarkets with no food. I saw what was going on in the environment. My question to you is, how can we mobilize ourselves in such a way as we are proactive in bringing down a system that is failing in such a way that it doesn't fail us and we don't fail each other?
Well, I mean, that's just a deep $64,000 question, but that's exactly what we're trying to do. And because one does not have full control over the forces that affect one, one has to be jazz-like, improvisational, flexible, and fluid in how you proceed. There's no such thing as a plan, capital P, that you impose on a fluid and dynamic reality. But most importantly, and we say this on behalf of our families and what has shaped us, that we're going to keep love at the center of it. Ain't no doubt about that. And justice is what love looks like in public.
Yeah.
Because when things begin to disintegrate, that's when the hatred and revenge and viciousness begin to surface in a more explicit way. And that's true for any community. And in such a moment, if you don't have folk committed to love and justice, then as Curtis used to say, if there's a hell below, we all gonna go. So that's the reason why this love is fundamental, and yet love is a dangerous thing. It's a crucial thing, and yet at the same thing, it's the most magnificent way of being in the world.
The only thing I would add to that, the only thing I would add to Doc's brilliant response is that I've often been asked or have often heard, or anytime I want to be reminded, I can just go on the internet and read somebody blogging asking, who the heck does Tavis think he is? Who does Cornel West think he is? Let me answer that question. I know who I am. And what I am is a broadcaster. I'm a broadcaster. I have a platform on television, I have a platform on radio, I have a platform on the internet, I have a platform vis-a-vis the books that I write and publish, I have a platform vis-a-vis the public speaking that I do. I am simply a broadcaster. I'm only saying that because I believe that courage can be contagious, that courage can be contagious. And when more of us use the platforms that we have, you know, to brighten the corner, as the old song says, Reverend Moore, brighten the corner where you are. Someone far from harbor, you may guide across the march, just brighten the corner where you are. Each of us is called upon to do the best we can with what we have right where we are. The best we can with what we have right where you are. That's what you're doing. That's what Doc is doing. That's what I'm trying to do. But I'm hoping and believing that if I beat the drum, if I ring the bell, and Doc beats the drum, and you beat the drum, and you beat the drum. Before you know it, it's like a marching band. You can hear the drums way down the street. So we got to get more Americans who are living poverty. This is no longer just a narrative that people have to read. They're living this every day. And you give a wonderful story, not story, but a wonderful recollection about your time in Moscow, your time in Russia. And that's what's happening in this country. We keep saying everywhere on this tour, poverty is threatening our democracy. We keep saying poverty is a matter of national security. We keep saying poverty is the moral, the spiritual issue of our time. And we're just dumb enough to believe that if we tell the truth, if we tell it like it is, and people hear that, and it touches them, and they start sharing that, and others share that, and it keeps moving in that way, that somebody is going to have to listen.
That's right.
Something is going to have to change. Something is going to have to happen, or very simply, we lose our democracy. It's just that simple. We're going to lose this thing called this democratic experiment. And so I'm just one guy with another guy who I love and would take a bullet for in my heart, not my right arm, not my left leg, right in my heart. And I'm just hoping that the work that we are doing will get people to talk about the issue.
And what we tell each other when we are demonized and marginalized, that we are redeemed sinners with gangster proclivities trying to tell the truth and bear witness. That's who we are. And that's the best we ever gonna be. But that redeemed sinner makes a difference. Because it means there's a grace coming in your life that empowers you no matter all the lies told about you, and you keep your eye on something positive rather than negative. We're not gangsters, but we still got gangster proclivities.
So y'all pray for us. Y'all pray for us. Yes, sir.
Well, I want to thank you both. My name is Robert Peters. I'm a Mennonite church minister and attend a Quaker meeting. You could hold us responsible for starting Pennsylvania and Philadelphia. And a perspective I wish I would have heard today, I'd love to hear your talk about Martin Luther King. Dr. King, I think, had the most powerful statement ever about poverty, and that's his 1967 Riverside Church speech.
We'll be there tonight. We'll be there tonight.
Where King, as you know, really said, in the last 3 hours, we have spent, I checked, about $60 million blowing the crap out of brown-skinned people in Iraq and Afghanistan. I talk about principalities and powers.
Oh, yeah.
I talk about the military-industrial complex that has a power over us spiritually and economically. Think about what we could do with the $1 trillion we have used in this country to kill our children, to kill our children. That was Dr. King's point, 67.
That's right.
When I go to Dr. King's celebrations at Germantown Friends School, they're just talking about cleaning up the neighborhood. They forget his 67 speech. They forget how correct he was in his spiritual and political analysis. And I just want to urge you to go to YouTube. It's on YouTube.
Oh, yeah.
Deal deeper with Dr. West's wonderful work. I studied with a fellow called John Howard Yoder at the seminary in Elkhart, Indiana. Up the road, we talked about the politics of Jesus. I've spent my life working on poverty issues, coming to conferences like this. And the thing, the big elephant in the room we often don't talk about, I worked first for Community Action Agency. You go to Community Action movements with folks, nobody wanted to talk about war, the $700 billion a year.
That's right.
That we could use. I've been to China. My wife's an attorney in China. You go to China, you'll see 200-300 million people lifted out of poverty. You'll see a high-speed train that could take you to New York City in 22 minutes. I've ridden on this train. The cost of that train, $30 billion, what we're going to blow 1 week in Afghanistan and Iraq.
First of all, we couldn't agree with you more, number one. Number two, we applaud the work that you are doing and have done. Number three, we were just in China a couple of years ago. We did a whole special for 5 nights on PBS about poverty in China. So Doc and I have been there and talked about global poverty, not just in this country. But the speech that you referenced, of course, the Beyond Vietnam speech that Dr. King gave, it was the most controversial speech he ever gave. We want to, as Doc says all the time, we want to sanitize and deodorize and manicure Dr. King and make him just a dreamer. But King was the most dangerous man in America. And the only weapon that he ever used was what? Love. That was his weapon, nothing but love. So King said in that speech that the U.S., this is King in 67, one year to the day he was killed later. He gives a speech April 4, 1967 at Riverside, where we're going to be tonight. We run out of here in 30 minutes to catch a train. We're at Riverside tonight, where he was on April 4, 1967. He's killed dead like a dog April 4, 1968, a year to the day. But King said two things in that speech, that the U.S. in 67, he called the U.S. the greatest purveyor of violence in the world today. That's what he said about his own country, number one. Number two, in that very speech, King said, for the purposes of our conversation today, that war is the enemy of the poor. That's the point our dear brother was making, that war is the enemy of the poor, and you get that point. And the last thing that Doc and I always talk about, and most folk don't know this because it never happened, but had King made it, King is killed down, King is shot on a Thursday in Memphis. If he had made it back to Ebenezer that Sunday morning, to be in his pulpit where he was headed after the march. If he'd made it back, he'd already called in, the phone records indicate he'd called in to his church back in Ebenezer, back in Atlanta. He called in and talked to his assistant, his secretary and talk to his father. And you know how we do it in most of these Baptist churches. Many of them, when you get to church Sunday morning, you got the church bulletin with the sermon topic already typed in the bulletin. So King called his sermons in a couple of days ahead of time. And we already know, we know from history, what King was going to preach that Sunday had he made it back to Atlanta. And what was his sermon theme going to be that Sunday, Doc?
He was going to preach on why America may go to hell. He didn't say America ought to go to hell. He didn't say America should go to hell. He said why America may go to hell. Because he knew when he came out against the war and connected it to organizing poor people of all colors, I know we're going to get to you, Bill, that 72% of Americans disapprove of him and 55% of black people disapproved of Martin after that. It's easy to love him in the grave, but when he's alive and well. And the reason was, and this is a challenge in the age of Obama, because he saw so many folk waving the flag and not wanting to bear the cross. Everybody's so patriotic. Everybody's so concerned about a flag. And he said, no, I'm called to a cross, and every flag is beneath that cross. It's beneath unconditional love. It's beneath that unarmed truth. And I'm going to bear witness of that truth and that love no matter what nation I'm talking about, because nationalism became a form of idolatry and lost sight of the humanity of other people. That's why nobody wants to say a mumbling word about those innocent folk being killed by U.S. drones dropping bombs on innocent folk. As if those innocent Pakistanis and those folk in Somalia and others don't have the same value in the eyes of God as any baby of any color in any nation in any continent. That's what the movement was about, and Martin was a threat. My dear brother, you've been very kind. I'm patient. Come right in.
We got 2 minutes. I want to get all three of these questions in. So whatever your comment or question is, if you can give it to me quick before we go off the air, I want to get all three of them in right quick.
All right. Thank you very much. My question is, up in Philadelphia, they started something last year where they got rid of people who had felony records so you can go out and get a job. And what I found out was in my hometown, Lancaster, Pennsylvania, I couldn't get a job because of my record. I couldn't get a medical card to help me to find out what's going on in my body. I had to come to Whole Ways of Philly this year to get a medical card and to get a new start in life. I want to know how come the whole entire United States is not on that same program.
I love that question. Thank you. Yes, sir.
First, thank you for the continuing education. I appreciate it so much. I'm with Occupy Philadelphia and the Money Out of Politics Working Group, as well as a Root Striker. And I'm wondering, a lot of what we talked about all dealt and came back to how the corrupting influence of money influences our government, whatever those issues are. That's a very difficult conversation to have. It's a very difficult concept. I like that you keep on referring back to it. How can we get the rest of America to understand that at the heart of a lot of these problems is that corrupting influence, and we don't have our government anymore. The rich, the wealthy do because of that influence.
We appreciate that. Yes, sir. Last question, comment.
Good afternoon. As we talk about the poverty in America and what the government can do for us, but we need to speak about our own accountability as far as what can we do to make the program work for us. And what I'm saying is, as parents, we have to make sure we are sending our kids to school, because when we're able to articulate our problem, then more people are going to listen to what we have to say. Yeah. And we shouldn't worry about Kobe showing up at the game with headphones, the Beats by Dre. We need to worry about did he walk up with a book in his hand or something like that. So these are the things that we also need to talk about, our accountability to this also.
Doc, in light of these last questions, your final thoughts? You want to wrap some final thoughts around that?
Well, just something special about Philadelphia. You know, this spirit has been so intense. The dialogue is so nuanced and subtle. And, of course, this special consecrated space, this church with courageous and visionary prophetic leadership. There he is right there. Reverend William Martin, there's the First Lady.
Pauline Moore, First Lady.
Where's Sister Tamika?
Reverend Tamika Moore, wherever she is.
Where's Sister Tamika? Oh, there she is.
Reverend Tamika Moore, yes.
No, that makes a difference. It makes a difference. We're so blessed to be here.
We want to thank, as Dr. West just said, Pastor William B. Moore, First Lady Pauline Moore, Reverend Tamika Moore, and the entire 10th Memorial Baptist Church family. Let's give them all love one more time for having us in, the entire church family. We thank you, we thank you, we thank you. Give yourselves a round of applause for sitting here for 3 hours. Come on, don't you love yourself? Give yourself some love. 3 hours, we love you. We are applauding you for being here for this conversation. We thank Pacifica and Native Voice One for carrying this program across the nation and our media sponsor, HuffPost. And we thank locally, WURD. Give some love to WURD.
Wake up with Bill. Wake up with Bill.
Carrying this program as well. Thank you for listening to the Poverty Tour 2.0 from Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. Next stop, Florida. God bless you. Thank you for coming out today.
Ladies and gentlemen, don't forget they have food in the back. If you guys, but we ask that if you go, you come around the side of the church. Please come out the side.
God can use me. You